This episode is again a sort of a merging of a bunch of little ideas. Originally, at the start of the season, we just had this idea that a kid was going to crap his pants, and Cartman was going to be asked to not fan the flames as he had done before. And so, actually, the first few scenes of him in with the principal and Mr. Mackey, where they're saying that this kid had done this, and we want you to help us, make it because the last kid had killed himself and all that. We'd actually had that as an idea for a show a while ago, and we thought where it was going to go was that it was going to be this thing where Cartman was going to actually try to help this kid, and how he was going to try to divert all the tension and make it so that this kid didn't kill himself. And then it just ended up becoming about a whole lot more. It really was a whole TMZ thing, and then WikiLeaks with the phone hacking, and then as soon as we said the word WikiLeaks, for some reason, LemmyWinks came to mind. And
yeah, it was like, WikiLeaks is such a weird name anyway, and then it reminded us of LemmyWinks. We came up with Bastamouth and Asta Trout, and then we knew that we had to do that.
There used to be a lot more of that in this show, and it all got cut out, because it's way funnier in the room than it was on the screen. But it was also, too, for a long time, we'd been figuring out how to bring LemmyWinks back, and then we had the idea of his evil brother, WikiLeaks.
That's really all we had. And we tried to spin it into a whole episode.
I just remember this one was tough because we kept going in all these different directions. And then it's sort of one of those shows that easily could have been two different episodes.
Yeah.
Because there was so much just with them approaching Cartman and trying to get him to.
I mean, there's a little bit about, Cartman saying, you don't understand the way the world works. It's kind of like with technology now and everybody wanting to appear in everyone's messages and stuff. There's no such thing as, secrecy or, and that was kind of where we talked about, the commonality between WikiLeaks and the phone hacking thing and TMZ is just this, wanting to get into other people's shit. In England, when it finally was, that girl who got murdered, then everyone got pissed off. But it was, before that, everyone was stoked on it.
Yeah.
So we kind of talked about that, too, that how hard it is for the kids to resist until it's about them. And then we had a little gerbil with a microphone on his head. That was about. That's about how smart it got. Very serious episode.
And I remember we had to get when we knew there was going to come to a fight between WikiLeaks and LemmyWinks. And it was one of those again where we found video footage of two squirrels fighting. And they just animated that because the way squirrels fight are really funny and the way that they'll stand up and kind of chirp at each other. And so for the longest time in the cut, we just had this real video footage of two squirrels fighting while they sat there and kind of painstakingly rotoscoped the whole thing.
Yeah, we rotoscoped it and then worked on it, Maybe it should have been two episodes, this one.
Yeah, we always regret that because then we, of course, the following weeks we run out of ideas and we're like, boy, we wish we would have made that two episodes. All right.
Turn public opinion around. You're crazy.
I mean, look, guys, I know it was just the Dolphins.
So after we had done Book of Mormon, which we did with our friend Bobby Lopez, it was really fun working with Bobby, and he's a really funny guy. So at some point during that whole thing, we're like, you should come one week and do an episode of South Park with us and just, be in the room and kick around ideas. We really didn't, when he arrived on Thursday, we got in the room and we kicked around a whole, it was also Halloween time. So we're like, well, we could just do a Halloween show. We didn't necessarily think we were going to do anything about Broadway or musicals until we kind of had this idea that maybe, what if we blatantly do the thing that's trying to make Broadway cool for dudes and that it's all about bros and everything. And, it's always scary when you go into a show like this and you've got to write a bunch of songs because even though they're short, it's still a bunch of songs you got to write. So,
and then I remember you wrote that song for the middle with the Tim Tebow song.
Yeah, and that's what I'm most proud of because
Tim Tebow song.
We actually, if you look at when this aired, it was actually October 26th of 2011, which was before Tebow Mania started at all. It was the first week he started playing. And I wrote all these Tim Tebow songs, just sort of predicting all that. And then Tebow Mania really happened.
I think you started Tim Tebow Mania.
I think I did. But we wrote the songs.
Then Bro Down and Broadway. That's kind of when the Bro Down is the best part of the show. The Stephen Sondheim and stuff, and they come in the Hooters and do the Bro Down. It's like, bro, that's really funniest.
But I remember I kept putting it off, and like we'd written a couple of the songs for like the Wicked parodies, but there were all these other songs like the montage when Randy's in New York, and then we needed other songs for Randy's musical and everything. And Bobby kept saying, like, when are we going to write those? And I'm like, oh, we'll worry about that later because we were just trying to figure out the story. And then it got to be like Tuesday, and Bobby's like, when are we going to write those songs? And I was like, yeah, I guess we should write those now. And we were just like frantically writing songs on Tuesday. And we got it all done.
Yeah. I wish Bobby could just move to L.A. and just work on South Park all the time. It'd be great. We'd have fun working with him. But unfortunately, he has a life and a big career and everything. But he's like, that was such a cool thing to have him come out. Maybe we can get him to do it again.
Yeah, probably.
We don't have to do a musical episode.
No,
do
we're gonna.
You know? All right, let's move on. That's the job. Jobs and me.
So this is the show we did because all these 99%er rallies were happening all over the country. And
we thought we'd say something really smart about it.
Yeah.
So here it was.
We had had the idea before about Cartman. It was actually going to be that he was going to have a heart attack at school because his health was so bad. But then we, with the 99% rallies, we thought, oh, no, it'll be good that he's, you know, his health is so bad that it kind of affects everybody else.
Right. He's, yeah.
But it also
he's
came
throwing
from
a curve.
The big thing that happened was there was a scene in episode 201 where we were kind of bringing back a lot of old things from South Park. There was a big scene where, because in that episode we had brought back Mitch Connor and Jennifer Lopez on Cartman's hand. And we had this big scene in that where Cartman was sitting at the table having tea with all his stuffed animals again, because that was another big callback. And he was telling his mother to sit down because he wanted to talk about who his father was again. And anyway, it ended up being this big scene that was cool, but we had to cut out of that entire show because we just didn't have time for it. And it wasn't totally necessary. So we had always kind of saved that scene in our back pocket of like, that's a cool scene. If we ever want to revisit the sort of stuffed animals and the tea parties, maybe we can find another reason to do it. And so we had kind of had this other idea rolling around where at some point Cartman knows he's got to get rid of his stuffed animals, but he's got to do it in Cartman's way, which is to slowly, you know, have it be all about murder and who killed who and everything and finally shoot one of them and kill her. And so it was sort of a good... Pretty quickly, we thought, oh, we could marry this whole idea of the 1% or 99% with this old idea we had of Cartman with his stuffed animals, and that's how it all kind of
came. Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to be Cartman just kind of need to grow up. It's like, dude, you need to grow up. It's like, and his whole thing of like, oh, I'm the 1%, I'm fat. It's like, you need to start eating better. You need to get rid of your stuffed animals was this whole thing. And, of course, Cartman can't just do that. He has to create a whole drama to make it happen. And I don't even remember. I mean, we tried to make fun of the 1% stuff. It just wasn't that funny. You know, we tried to do a little bit more of that. But the stuff with Cartman ended up being much, you know, watching Cartman's whole internal dialogue happen.
Yeah.
Just seemed to be much better.
Well, just to know that he'll even go to these extremes and fuck around, even when there's no one's benefit but his own.
Yeah.
Like, even just to convince himself, you know, it's like he can't possibly just listen to everyone and say, oh, maybe I should grow up.
Yeah, no, he's truly nuts. Remember, we had to figure out when Kyle breaks in and Stan breaks into Token's house in the end, we had to figure out, okay, we have to make sure there's actually time for Cartman to go run and put that whole setup in the end and make sure that it does sort of make sense what Cartman, you know, does in the end.
And so we had all of his old stuffed animals, but then we also decided to put in a Marc Jacobs stuffed animal because we had seen this thing about a year ago. We'd seen a picture in a magazine of Marc Jacobs, and we saw that he actually had a tattoo of Clyde Frog and Rumpelstiltskin.
Yeah.
And we're like, and someone pointed it out to us and said, look, Marc Jacobs has these tattooed on. We're like, wow, that's pretty sweet.
That guy's fucking dedicated.
So we thought, like, let's just do a little homage to that, and we'll have Cartman now have a little Marc Jacobs doll. And as you can see, the Marc Jacobs doll actually has little tattoos of Clyde Frog and Rumpelstiltskin on him. So it's kind of funny. But then, apparently, Marc Jacobs saw this episode, did this interview where he said like it was the greatest honor of his life.
Oh, he sent us a nice little card. He sent us a nice little card saying how honored he was.
And then he went and got a tattoo of the Marc Jacobs doll on him, which is sweet because he's got now, Marc Jacobs has a tattoo of Marc Jacobs, which has a tattoo of Clyde Frog and Rumpelstiltskin on him.
That makes me like Marc Jacobs.
That's why he's a designer. Like, we wouldn't have thought of that.
That's really smart.
All right.
Let's move on.
What are you guys talking about?
So this episode was our Thanksgiving special, and it came out on November 9th. And a lot of people asked us, why did we do our Thanksgiving special 3 weeks before Thanksgiving and not the last episode of the season? And the answer, it's two reasons. One, because we couldn't think of anything else that week. We had this idea. This was one of the first ideas we had when we got together at the beginning of the season. We're like, okay, good. We have our last episode figured out, which will be a Thanksgiving special. But then we got to this week, and we just couldn't think of any other shows. We're like, well, we could do the Thanksgiving special. And then we kind of fooled ourselves into thinking, we'll do the Thanksgiving special. Let's get going. And we'll make it two parts.
Yep.
And that way, it makes sense that we're doing it now.
Yeah.
But then, of course, by Monday, we got into it and we're like, this is never going to be two parts. So it's just going to be a Thanksgiving special, and then there'll be some other random show. But we think about that stuff too much, too. It just probably didn't really matter that much. But
didn't matter to me in the end. We thought it would matter. And then we thought, oh, we'll do a Christmas special. That's why we had to do a Thanksgiving special. And it just making things worse. So yeah. Then we decided, fuck it. Let's just leave it. No one's going to care. And really, no one does care.
But it kind of came from two things. One being Thor, because I saw Thor on DVD, and I actually kind of liked it. I thought it was cool. And then also the stuff we've been talking about a long time, which was History Channel and the way that they have all these shows on History Channel that have nothing to do with history. And in fact, they have all these shows about UFOs and like monsters and stuff and ghosts. And it's just like by putting it on something called History Channel, I think you're really...
Ancient Aliens is just pretty brutal.
That's the worst.
I mean, this little parody right here of like Thanksgiving is really... 1% more, like, it adds 1% of satire on top of what Ancient Aliens already pretty much is.
Yeah.
So, it was just kind of like this. When we started talking about it, it was like that idea when you come, you go, you know what, Thor, and then Thor, the movie, sort of is like Ancient Aliens, right? I mean, the whole idea is like, well, ancient, there's this advanced civilization a long time ago that came from space and the Earth, and, but at least it's a fucking movie based on a comic book. It's not called the History Channel. So when we put those two together, I really like Thor too. I actually watched it because we're going to do this episode.
It was one of those.
Once we came up with the idea of like, there's also we kind of did a little bit in this in the end, but there's this thing that's happening in like, I guess it's kind of like steampunk aesthetic, but like there's this thing happening in big movies where it's like three musketeers, in this year, like for instance, it's like Three Musketeers and Sherlock Holmes, where it's kind of like 200 years ago and stuff, but it should be like, it's like everything's fucking sweet, you know, in the 1800s and stuff. So that's, we talked about like with the final battle and stuff that was, these ships that were, way too fucking sweet.
Yeah. And it was luckily, since we did have the idea at the beginning of the season, we were able to get everyone modeling all of this stuff. Because that's always a problem when we have a big idea like this where there's all this crazy intergalactic battles. It's like, how do we get everything drawn in time for the show? And so we actually cut this together. We actually did a joke out of it where we made a trailer for Pilgrims versus Indian, sort of a Thor-like trailer. And we were going to put that in the episode Asperger's as another kind of like, coming June 16th, fuck you, like as a joke, and then actually do the show at the end of the season. And we ended up not doing that, but it helped us because we were able to have the artist draw all the different pilgrims and the ships and all that stuff. And so we had a bit of a jump on it, which was very necessary.
Maybe we should have done two. I think this episode turned out pretty good.
Yeah.
And Natalie Portman. And she's the wormhole.
Yeah, and it just becomes a big rip on Natalie.
For no reason.
For no reason. All right.
One more.
See what I mean, you guys?
So now we're at the last show of the season, and we were definitely running a little low on ideas, but then luckily for us, the whole Penn State thing happened. And so sometimes, when we're trying to think of ideas, we'll just say, well, let's just try to do a show centering around this character. And we hadn't done anything around Kenny for such a long time that I remember this whole discussion started as like, what can we do with Kenny and kind of make it about him? And we had had the idea before that he gets sent to a foster home. And so that we started just kicking around that whole thing.
Yeah, that's where it started, was what if he gets sent to a foster home? And then we went through like the normal, like, it took us a while to get like, what's the joke of the foster home? Because the thing about like, oh, there's this, mechanized, industrialized thing where they try to adopt kids to make money. It's like, I don't know, it seemed like it had been done before or whatever. And then,
goes to a rich home, that seems so dumb.
Yeah, so then we came up with the idea of like, well, a lot of foster homes are pretty religious people who, for religious reasons find it that's kind of why they want to adopt a bunch of kids and stuff. Then we came up. We came upon the idea of the militant agnostics, and that seemed like there was something to go on. And that stuff ended up being really funny. And it ended up going on with Mysterion and being like, at least in the end, when they're going looking around for him, like Mysterion can leave a question mark and it freaks him out and stuff. So, but really, I mean, it was really lucky that the Penn State thing happened at this time, because that gave us some real fuel.
Well, and we always,
and this was about a week after that, right? Yeah, it was like the week
it
after.
It was right around that.
There were people who said too soon, and they were probably right, but it sure was funny.
But we also, I remember that part of the idea was, you know, we've seen Kenny's brother and sister a lot of times in the show, and we never even named them, really. I think we had to go back to, like, season four to see one time their names had been mentioned to see what they were. And so we were just like, can we get into their characters at all? And then we ended up not really getting so much into their characters, but we just thought it was a cool thing that Kenny had to be kind of Mysterion for his little sister. And then we have my...
Also is a way where Kenny can talk, too. Yeah. Makes him...
Our friend Chris Borkovec, who's a cop, he's the person we go to when we need to talk about these kind of things. He told us about this room, which is... Wasn't it called the safe room?
Soft room. Yeah.
Which
that's
is
what a kid is, yeah.
Yeah, in police departments. He's like, they have a soft room where kids in this situation are you know, put in, and they usually have, like, they try to make it feel a little kid-like and happy. And so so that's when we came up with the idea for this scene. And he ends up, Chris did some voices in the show, too. Neverland Ranch, a Catholic church, or Penn State University. But all in all, we were... pretty glad that we got this whole season behind, because we knew it was going to be a rough one having to do Book of Mormon and two seasons at the same time in the same year. And so when we got this one behind us, we were pretty happy.
Come on now, how
about that smile? But then we found out after doing this that we'd have to wait like a month and a half, almost 2 months, to be able to do this commentary. We were really sad.
It's fucked up my whole holidays.
And,
I can't think about anything.
We couldn't really have a good Christmas or a good New Year's.
I haven't been able to think about anything.
I remember I called Matt on Christmas and was like, do you think we could do the commentary now? Is there any way? And they were just like, no, you got to wait a few more weeks.
We wanted to do it on Christmas Day, but the crew, you know, we had to give them off and stuff. But it's been tough. It's been tough.
But with all that being said, for all of you listening, thanks so much.
Do we only do this once a year? Doesn't it seem like we do this like,
it seems like we do this
fucking every 2 weeks? It's like, God damn it.
And we love it so much.
But I'll see you next year.
Thanks so much, and we'll make some more. Bye. Who's the poorest kid
in school now? Pretty much went through everybody. Craig's got the most... Here he comes.
Hi, everyone. This is Trey Parker.
And Matt Stone.
And we're back for more commentary on our shit.
And don't we sound excited?
It's so much fun.
This is our favorite thing to do.
As we sit here at the South Park offices, we're actually working on the video game, The Stick of Truth. That's what we're trying to finish right now. So we've been called in to discuss things that happened a long time ago. This episode, Reverse Cowgirl, I think we did back in March.
Yeah, I even though it's not really about that, well, kind of a little bit, it this was the main thing was, this is how it started, was talking about...
leaving the seat down and it being this big war between men and women and, like, what's the worst that could possibly happen. And then we had this image of Clyde's mom stuck in the toilet and her dying, and that's all we had for this show. But we animated that scene, the scene that's coming up where she's actually stuck in the toilet and dies, and that's all we had, and we just thought that was so goddamn funny that we sort of went with that for the first show. And I remember it got to be like Friday and Saturday, and we were like trying to come up with other things.
Well, I think it was because we talked about... I think it was my... I think it was my wife. I was... Yeah, always, any time you, like... If you're a dude, you've had that... You've either lived with a girl, a roommate, or you've been married or whatever, and you have that conversation about you should put it up, you should put it down. And it's like, you... And so my thing was like, you put it... Some one person has to grab the gross seat. You do it. And then my wife's thing, which I've heard before from other women, is, but I could fall in. I could fall in. It could be night. I could fall in. And you're like, really? You could fall in the toilet. Like, that's really... You don't look before you just back.
Yeah.
You back up in the dark towards the fucking toilet.
You should look at a toilet before you sit on it.
You're falling. Is going to kill yourself? Like, come on. Or you'll get toilet water on your coochie? Like, what's the worst that can happen? And then that's how this episode was sort
and,
of born.
And then because we've had a lot of experience with the TCA doing a lot of flying back and forth, once we decided it'd be sort of, you know, the whole... It also came from this idea about you know, how having to change bathrooms, like people, the government regulating your bathroom and having to change it, like make your bathroom handicap accessible in your house. And actually, it was going to go that whole direction. And we ended up saving that for a for another show way down the line of the season. But then we just decided to do the whole sort of TSA thing in your bathroom.
Right. And the...
I'm telling you, it's hysterical.
Watching Carmen clip his nails was pretty funny.
This is where you play Roshonda and Roshonda, right?
Yeah.
Trey is Roshonda, I think, and Roshonda.
Yeah, I think I played both Roshonda and Roshonda.
I flew to New York a couple weeks ago, and I think I met Roshonda. She met me. Is there anything else in this? Do we have the butters on backwards? Do we have the that's on this, right?
Well, it was funny because for actually we had this idea for a long time. We had the idea of what if we're using toilets wrong? Like, doesn't it kind of make more sense that because we were talking about always wanting to use your laptop on the toilet, and we're like, now that we have laptops, wouldn't it be nice to have that little shelf? And we're like, well, maybe that's what it's supposed to be, because if you sit on a toilet backwards, you kind of have that natural shelf from the toilet itself. And so then we came up with this whole idea of like, oh, let's have it be that Butters has always messed it up and always sat on it wrong. But then we went to go animate it and we realized that the way our characters are drawn, Butters can't even really sit on a toilet backwards and have the shelf is like over his head. So it doesn't really work. It only works with an adult.
Yeah.
So we had to wait until we had this brilliant idea to actually use it.
Brilliant.
And here's this was the first scene animated of the whole thing. We didn't really know what was going to come before or after, but it all came out of this scene.
You just like this scene.
Yeah.
Clyde, right here.
I want you to know I don't blame you for this.
We should have been... All right, well, let's go to the next one.
Okay.
You left the toilet seat up.
So this episode, Cash for Gold, came out of just seeing all the people sprouting up with the signs everywhere saying Cash for Gold, Cash for Gold, and seeing the stores all sprouting up and kind of wondering, you know, starting to see a guy on every street corner and wondering kind of what was up. And so as we checked into it, we actually had one of the writers, we had Vernon go and take some gold to a Cash for Gold place just to see what it was like and what happened. So he took his wedding ring, and also I have some gold coins. And so I just gave him a gold coin that's 1 ounce of gold. You can look it up online exactly what it's worth that day. It was like $1,700 for an ounce of gold. And just to have him taken in and see like how much they tried to scam him or take him. And it was like basically for his wedding ring, they weren't going to give him really anything. And for the ounce of gold, they offered him like $900. So it was a little brutal, but not terrible. I mean, he went in there acting like he had no idea what it was worth. So they could have said, you know, $20. But
it was also because we talked about the jewelry network stuff.
Yeah, we were talking about diamonds and jewels in general. Because
and just going up, and we talked about your grandmother that bought all the shit online or something.
Yeah.
Like your grandmother, and it happens to a lot of old people where they'll you know, somebody will get really old, and or when they die, they go into their house and they've just got all this junky, gaudy jewelry that they bought online. And some of the jewelry, when you watch this stuff like Gem Network or Gem TV, so we started watching this shit, and it's unbelievable that people buy a $2,400 necklace or a $1,200 ring on TV.
Yeah.
Like, they don't even touch it. They just see it on TV in this shitty show, and they're like, oh, $1,200, you know what I mean?
But what made us laugh so much was how, and it's really not that exaggerated the way we do it in the show, where it's like they'll start off going, here's this emerald and diamond thing. We're going to sell this for $100,000, okay? $100,000, and then about a minute later, they're like, "What? We're gonna take the price down to $350." You know, it's just like, and everyone's like, "Oh my God, that's a $100,000 thing."
We're really gonna do this. We're really gonna sell it for $350. And they always have a Southern accent,
yeah,
so that they appear really dumb, so that you feel like at home that you're pulling one over on some dumb Southern hick. It's just unbelievable. And then I guess the montage does it when we go to India and stuff. But we really love that idea of just this whole industry that sort of sells you shit that's full of memories and like sentimentality. Then eventually you get in a place where you have to go sell it, and they melt all that sentimentality out of it.
Yeah.
And then they go to another guy, and then they resell you some same, you know, some different shit, so you can put some different feelings and some different love can be represented by it.
Yeah.
And just that whole hideous circle. This is kind of a cynical episode, actually. You know what I mean? It's just sort of like, this is what gold is. This is what jewelry is. It just fucking sucks. You know?
And one funny thing about this show, too, is we got a lot of times, if we like, we'll think of a montage or think of like a song or something, and it's like, okay, it should basically be like this. And sometimes I'll even just kind of hum it or do a little version just so I have something to cut with. And so we were in doing the dialogue, and then I just kind of did this just little half-ass, like, and it was just like, okay, I'll cut to that, and then we'll do the music for it. But it was one of those things where, as we were starting to cut the stuff, it was like how shitty that was, and just humming it like that was making us laugh. So instead of going and doing music to all that and everything, we just added some more layers to it. And I remember it was actually like 4 a.m. the day, you know, on our Tuesday nights, we were up all night trying to do it. When I was actually doing all the other parts to that, so it's like so stupid, so shitty.
Yeah, that song is super funny.
But it's funny too, because a lot of these shows like this, where we're like, oh, okay, let's make fun of those. You know, we all have passed in the channel flipping. We've passed these jewelry channels, and we kind of laugh at them. But now that we're gonna do a show about them, we gotta kind of sit and watch them for a little bit. And usually when that happens, whether it's Whale Wars or Finding Bigfoot, and you have to actually sit and watch it, you're like, dude, no fucking way. Like, and it's just like they're so brutally horrible and just like just play down to such horribly stupid people that it was pretty rough to have to sit there and watch
Gem Network. I remember we had a big thing with this on that channel flipping. Remember we did bloop bloop for the TiVo, because we're like, in the old days you would just quit static and that would show that you were changing channels.
Yeah, and we were still doing
really do that anymore. We're like, still doing that, like a record scratch. Like, it doesn't even mean anything anymore.
Why are we still doing static? No one flips a channel.
So we did a TiVo thing. We thought that was really clever and forward looking.
Even though TiVos are now way out.
You also notice that this is probably, I don't know how many episodes. We should keep account of how many fast food restaurants are in this season of South Park, because there's Taco Bell.
There's tons. You could see what was on our minds this round.
There's a lot of Taco Bell. There's Red Lobsters. There's probably some. There's a lot of fast food is becoming a big part of South Park.
All right, let's go on. Practically stolen from us. Ouch. So this was our memeing show, which way before this, we were talking about doing a planking show. But of course, with all these memes, as soon as you talk, even as fast as we can do stuff, it was like the next meme was in style. So as soon as we were talking about doing a planking show, it was already very passé. But then T-Bowing came, and we're like, oh, okay, let's do a T-Bowing show. But of course, that became passé within about a week and a half. So then we kind of checking into and what the whole just memeing in general, and can we just do a show about memeing and how quickly they do change? And that's when we came up with this.
And also, like, the whole thing where when planking got back in the news a few years ago, and some kid somewhere fell or died or some shit, you know, that actually had nothing to do with planking at all.
Yeah.
You know, it just had to do with like being out late and being drunk and being stupid. It could happen, and it does happen all the time. There was these stories online. It was like CNN.com. It was like, planking, is it dangerous? You know what I mean? Right. I mean, that's where it started, this idea that, like, that's where the show started, and especially, like, the train hitting you and the Olong Johnson and the reporter doing that and just taking that to a ridiculous extreme of, like, watch out when you plank. Because it seems like anytime there's a meme, the news sort of has to sort of go, like, is this dangerous?
Yeah.
Was your kids doing it? And it's like, it doesn't even matter. It's just, like, the whole pointlessness of it is the point of it. Like this right here, Faith.
We were happy to get the Olong Johnson cat in this, because we had to speak to a lot of agents and people that own the rights, and
we had to convince Olong Johnson himself to do it.
But that Olong Johnson cat just always made me laugh so hard, so we're like, how can we put him in the show?
I think these are these are some of our,
this is actually outside the South Park office. This is in our parking lot.
Yeah, that's in our office.
That's in
this
the office.
All people who work for us and work on South Park. That's Cartman. He doesn't work on South Park.
Yeah, and we don't even know how we came up with why it's called Faith Healing, because it obviously could just be anything. But
I'll say for the record right now, I did not know who Faith Hill is or what she looks like.
I only know from,
I don't care.
From Sunday Night Football.
I heard of the name. I've heard the name, and it made sense to me.
We just thought it was funny because she's just like the laziest Sunday Night Football performer ever.
She's the one that sings the beginning.
She sings the song.
On Sunday night.
Yeah, and she does it with like, she looks like she doesn't want to be there. It's just like really funny. And this was another example. This scene right here is the first scene we had for this show, where we were just talking about memeing and memeing safety in general, and we didn't know what was going to become before or after, but we just had this stuff with kids getting hit by trains that we thought was super funny.
And of course, they had to show it on 16 millimeter film.
Yeah,
bad registration. And have this guy has to have this greatest American hero haircut. Yeah.
All right, let's move on.
Let's move on.
Yeah.
This is Ryan and Barkley.
So this is Jupacabra. The whole idea for this show came from just wanting to make fun of that show, Finding Bigfoot, where it just came out of all those other paranormal shows that's on, where it's just like a crew of quote-unquote scientists go around with cameras and night vision and claim to be setting up things to catch Bigfoot on camera, and of course they never do. But they all act like, you know, they're professionals, and they... and this, like I was saying before, this is just a show that we had heard of the show, we had seen clips for it, but now we had to kind of sit down and watch it to see what to make fun of, and it was just more brutal and
it's if you haven't
stupid.
Watched it, well, don't. But if you do watch it, it's unbelievable how thin of soup they spin.
Yeah.
It's like 50 cups of water and like a little piece of chicken. There's nothing in that show, and it really is just a bunch of dopes going out in the wilderness. And if you've seen the rigs, you'll see with Butters and Cartman, they have these rigs so they can shoot their face looking for Bigfoot. And they basically drive out to somewhere on a dirt road, get out of the car, and you can just tell this from watching the way it's shot, walk about 30 feet off into the grass and start screaming for Bigfoot, and then they don't find Bigfoot, and they get back in the car and they drive
and they
back.
Every single show, every single commercial break, they go, wait a minute, what was that? And it goes dun dun dun, and it goes to commercial, and then they come back and go, okay, that wasn't anything, but what else do we have? And then every single commercial break they act like there's something, and you come back and find out there's not, and you don't know how people stay tuned. Like, how do you
you can get fooled once. You just start watching, all right, okay, that's, you know, but to make a whole season out of it. Oh, my gosh.
So this was a show where, you know, a lot of times with South Park, we come back from a season and we don't figure out whole shows ahead of time, but we get kind of little ideas like this, doing a parody of the big Finding Bigfoot thing, and we'll do a scene just to try to get, you know, a little bit ahead of the game. And so the scene we did of this was the scene where Cartman and Butters are out in their gear calling out for Bigfoot. And I think at that point, we hadn't really even figured out to make it a Passover special. It's just that then the timing all worked out, and we kind of looked at the calendar and said, oh, this is actually, this could, if this was our fourth show, then this can happen right around Easter, and we can make it a whole Passover thing. And that's when we came up with all the stuff, going the flashback back to Egypt and all that.
Yeah, I like this episode. It has like a real, has a weird kind of structure for us, the end especially. But it's really cool. The flashback is cool.
I really like the end where it was a reference to the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown, where Cartman's out there passed out, and Kyle, we just kind of did it shot for shot, where Kyle walks out of the house and goes and it's where Lucy finds Linus still asleep in the pumpkin patch and tucks him back into bed and everything, and so that's what makes Cartman wake up and realize he's going to be a Jew from now on, which I guess the next day he decided not to, because we've never talked about it again.
Yeah, we didn't really follow through with that. That it?
I think that's it.
I think that's all about that. Yeah.
But that's okay.
So this show was our bullying show, because bullying got really big there for like a week and a half, when everyone was like, all of a sudden, it was like, oh my God, kids get bullied.
A lot of celebrities were getting upset about kids getting bullied.
Well, there was that bully film.
Yeah.
And we talked a lot about, informed the story a bit, but it isn't really a huge point. We talked a lot about the movie and sort of what the movie is about, and also, but what really kind of like bothered us and we just kind of couldn't get our heads around was the marketing of the movie, and basically just, you know, the marketing of bullying, you know what I mean? And remember they were doing that whole thing about, there was that kid and he was on the poster, and it was like, you know, Harvey Weinstein was all of a sudden Mr. Anti-Bully, you know, like the biggest bully in the world, being all like, oh my God, people get bullied, you know? So, I mean, we started there, and also luckily the Joseph Kony guy who made that thing had that meltdown.
Yeah,
that
this was right after. He'd been caught jacking it in San Diego, and I was like, oh, that's a song. As soon as he was caught jacking in San Diego, I wanted to write a song about it. So I wrote several, actually, but this one made it into the show.
There was a lot of jacking it in San Diego.
Some ballads.
I haven't been to San Diego since. I don't know if I'd be able to go there without jacking it on that street corner.
But this also had, it was when we were starting to look on YouTube of different schools doing this whole anti-bullying thing, and they were doing these lip syncs where they were taking the camera and going through their school and having everyone, you know, one shot. That was the big thing. And I guess there's a name for it, too. Didn't we even figure out what
the
name
was? Yeah, I can't remember. There's some
name for
it.
There's a name for it, but like doing every, you know, take a song and one shot, have everyone do their part to that song. And we couldn't believe there was this whole culture just of doing that. And that a lot of them were sort of for the cause of let's stop bullying, but all the songs were just kind of like, hey, baby, you're the best, you know. Like,
yeah, sometimes they did it with pop songs. Some people just lip-sync pop, like Black Eyed Peas songs.
Yeah.
But then they started writing their own songs to stop bullying. Because if you do a single shot through the whole school and everybody's there being a part of it, no one got bullied that day.
Yeah, except for all the people that weren't allowed to do it because they're nerds.
So they were bullied.
They didn't even get to be there. So
if you can tell, we don't have much school spirit. This guy.
Oh, this guy. His haircut was based on Captain Kangaroo, of course.
Pretty obviously, yeah.
I think I even wrote in the script a Captain Kangaroo haircut. That's why we got this.
All right, how's that? Is that long enough?
Oh, that's I'm just so excited to go to the next one. Yeah.
That's mine.
So this is our zip lining show, which all happened because my girlfriend and I went ziplining in Kauai. We were down at a... I had never been ziplining before, and there's all these new ziplining companies showing up everywhere, but also in Kauai. And so I just had this genius idea of like, well, that sounds fun. Let's go ziplining. And I've basically never heard the end of it since then because it was just... That's all. Everything that happens in this show basically happened on my trip, where we drove a long way. We got there to the thing. We saw that there was a big tour, and of course, you know, everyone can identify with that thing of like suddenly realizing, oh, you're in a big tour group, and then saying, thinking, you know, okay, let's just start ziplining. But they're like, no, you got to get in the shuttle, and we're gonna drive a half an hour with this group of people, and then, you know, it just basically got worse and worse and worse. And that's when we thought of the idea of doing a I shouldn't be alive kind of thing, but with that feeling of knowing you've been stuck.
Yeah, I've never been ziplining. I went backcountry snowboarding, and it was the same thing where you sign up and you're all of a sudden you're off all day with 12 people that, you know, and you hope that there's no chodes in there.
You just hope they don't talk to you. That's
I don't want to talk to anybody, and I'm just, you know, that all that. Actually, my trip turned out all right, but that it's that fear of like, oh, and when you show up and you're like, oh, it's in a group, oh, you know, that you have. And it's also this episode was I
should be alive. Yeah,
yeah. And so that's where we came up with the Cartman, you know, his gastro tract stuff, because it's like in that show they always are, you know, they're always showing you what's happening to the human body as it starves or what happened, you know, the thirst and the inside of the body compared to the outside and what's going on. So,
and we actually found the narrator from I Shouldn't Be Alive. There's actually, oh, and yeah, then we find out there's two of them. And so at first I heard the guy we got, and I'm like, wait, that's not him. But I realized I was referring to seasons 4 and 5 or something like that. And I was like, narrator. No, this guy did do it.
He's in England, right? Way to go to.
Yeah, that's what's funny England. Is that he's a British guy that hides his accent to do the narration.
He kind of does this coup of voice, but yeah, he's got a proper English accent in normal life.
But so then the we actually started shooting some of the live action stuff in this before the run started. Not much, but just enough to kind of get an idea, like how would we do it? Because we didn't even know, like, will we have cartoon voices? Will they not talk? You know, how will we do all that? And so we went and shot some of the stuff, and we actually just went to my boat, which is in Marina Del Rey, and just kind of I think my dad mostly drove the boat around, and we just shot stuff in the back of the boat.
Yeah.
So it was just kind of like a day kind of tooling around in the marina. And we thought we'd have to go out in the ocean and get these kind of cool shots and everything, but then we realized, no, the point is nothing's really happening. So we were able to just tool around in the marina.
Yeah. We gave up early on and like, well, there's no palm trees in Colorado. We had actually were trying to figure out how they'd get to California, like, because there's these big palm trees. It's obviously Marina Del Rey. But we just gave up on that. We just gave a shit. Really fuck matter. It. Just like, who cares? This is why this what Cartman farts. Yeah, right. This
yeah,
is that joke.
That
was, Cartman, did you fart? That was this made me laugh so hard.
Funny the part. Did you fart?
Yeah. You go through that whole thing. You fart.
Yeah. All right.
That's it for this. Inside Kyle's mouth, the muscles contract to force a smile.
So this is kind of interesting because this was the last show of this run, but only the middle of the season. So what actually happened is we came up with the idea for Sarcastaball, which is going to end up being the first show of the next run. But because all this stuff started coming out about concussions in the NFL and all that stuff. So we came up with the idea, the basic joke premise of Sarcastaball. And we had even done the scenes of Randy with the PTA and talking to them, you know, sarcastically coming up with this whole new game. And we're like, okay, well, this is funny, but we need something for the boys to do. And so we started to come up with the idea of like, okay, maybe there's something on the field. The girls are cheerleaders. The boys are football players. And maybe there's a little love story with like a new girl and she's black. So we came up with this whole thing that we started to think was funny where it's like, okay, this black girl moves in and Carmen's just sure she has to be with Token because she's black. And so he starts playing Cupid. And what happens a lot of times in a show like that is that part just became so funny to us that by Friday or Saturday, we still had both ideas going and we just realized they were just two huge ideas that could be their own episode. So we pulled them apart, and then by like Saturday night we were kind of screwed because we had not very many minutes, but we just had this really funny premise that just kept on giving with Cartman, and then we came up with the little Cupid guy, and then that's where we just started dedicating entire scenes to the Cupid guy. And it was just like, we just loved that. But
just Cartman is just, he's having a love story basically. I mean, he's having all the beats of a love story, but just, you know, butterflies in his stomach and loss and then breakup and all this stuff. But
yeah,
but of course he's that guy that, of course, oh, Token, of course this would be your girlfriend.
It was an interesting thing to get a little technical for the writers out there. It was kind of an interesting thing because it's sometimes we always battle with like, okay, is this too much story? Because if you start cramming too much in, then you don't have time to let things breathe and be funny. And there's just too much plot. And when there's too much plot, sometimes the show isn't so good. But then, of course, you want to know. So it was always this battle of like, okay, well, are those two stories? Can we keep Sarcastaball and this whole Token love story thing going? And finally, what we kind of realized I kind of try to remind myself all the time now is that the reason they were too big of ideas is because they both had kind of points to them. They both had themes. So if it was just this little love story and it didn't matter on the side, that would have been fine. But Sarcastaball had this whole big kind of meta joke to it. And then this had this whole big meta joke to it, which is sort of the racist kid just assuming the black kid should be together. And because of that, we finally realized that's what makes it two shows and not one, because there's two sort of points going on.
Yeah, the two separate tones almost, too. Yeah. Like, it was hard to go from the Sarcastaball stuff is such a weird tone. And you go back to this and it was just jarring.
So it was interesting because we did, like I said, we had full scenes, probably three or four scenes of Sarcastaball that we just cut out. And then we had to go back and reanimate things that were on a football field. And we kept the girls as cheerleaders. But you'll notice that later on in the show, there's a scene where Cartman talks to the little girl when he tells her that he's gay. He and Kyle are gay together. And they're just kind of out on a football field. And if you watch it now, you're kind of like, well, why are they even on a football field? So, you know, actually, you wouldn't even think about it. But the reason they are is because it was still part, those shows used to be together. So then we went back and reanimated it all, taking just the football uniforms off the boys and just kept the girls as cheerleaders. Kind of interesting.
Yeah. And that's that.
So that's it. Let's go to the next season because that one's so good.
Hooray.
Go Cows!
So now this was actually starting the second half of the season. Starting up in September, I guess we did. So it was good because we came into the building and basically had these scenes that we had taken out of the show before when Cartman Finds Love kind of took over the story. And so we still had this stuff and we thought, well, it'll be good to walk into it because football season will be starting. It'll actually be a little more relevant.
Yeah, it was better timing, I think, than doing it in the spring before. Kinda.
But we sort of still had the same problem, which was, okay, well, now we have this big Randy story, but we had nothing with any of the boys, and so we really struggled with that for a while until we came up with Butter's Creamy Goo.
Yeah, and then that's really what cracked it, was Butter's Creamy Goo.
And then we just did a lot of Butter's Goo jokes.
This was a really weird episode, I know, writing-wise and stuff, just because the sarcastic, like, have everything be sarcastic but sort of work, you know what I mean, and sort of drive the story forward. I just remember being in the writer's room where every time we're like, God, everything seemed backwards, and like you had to say
Yeah, you know what I mean? Every line had to mean it, but they didn't mean it, but then they kept going with it. Yeah, not sure if that's the cake or perhaps a loaf of bread. My favorite, but I guess we really, it was Butter's Creamy Goo, and when we came around to that, you know, because we were trying to strike this balance in this episode of just kind of like, okay, what do we really want to say? And what we really kind of settled on, and, you know, kind of like try to find this very specific thing was people who, like, you know, when you read internet comments and people who, like, watch football but, like, don't give a shit about, you know, the play. As soon as you say, well, let's make it a little safer, let's make this rule, they go, oh, what are they going to wear, skirts? You know, and it's like, you know, and so that was Butter's Creamy Goo. Once we came up with that brilliant Butter's Creamy Goo concept, putting that and making that, like, and it just feels like when we came up with the end of the when the end of the show could come around to like, okay, right, then now they're just going to drink cum. Thanks. It was like the whole kind of like the point was made of like, you know.
I remember a long time we were talking in the room about, and we didn't know if we were going to get it. We didn't know if we were going to be able to get Randy when he takes that thing and goes, this is cum. Like, we're just like, we came up with that. We're like, wait, are they going to let us say that? And it's like, it was one of those things where we had to go back and tell them, well, like, well, look, it's the point of the whole thing. Like, yeah. if we can't say this is cum, which, of course, we don't have to
we
say
don't
this
have
is
to
cum,
say it,
but we made it sound like that. We had to.
It's also Randy's on this weird sarcastic trip the whole time, and then just at the end, he just takes a drink and goes, this is cum.
Yeah. So the most non-sarcastic sentence in the entire show.
In the writer's room, we said that like 400 times. I just think that's the funniest read, too.
So this scene here with the PTA and then the scene after were actually done before. And the whole scene with Jim Rome, which is what we thought was really funny.
Yeah.
I listen to Jim Rome a lot in the morning. Matt likes Jim Rome.
I love Jim Rome. Yeah, I don't listen to him as much, but Trey does a really good Jim Rome. And Jim Rome, I mean, Jim Rome uses sarcasm. I mean, like, he uses it. He's like a really, I think, a really good guy. He seems like a really good guy and a really thoughtful guy, but and sort of he uses sarcasm to sort of like, you know, cut
sometimes
to
a lot, which I can't
sometimes
imagine
a lot. I mean, he's the most sarcastic guy, but I mean, he does it in service of good, you know, of good points.
If you have to talk for 3 hours every day, I mean, you can see that we do try to do these to 3 minutes a show. If you had to do 3 hours a day, I'd be doing the same thing, going, yeah, this is a good show. This is a great show. This is a show I want to watch 5 times. Show I want to watch 15 times. Just anything you can do to just say the same thing.
You ever like listen to Jim Rome, and there has pauses in his show that are so loud or long. You think your radio kind of broken? Yeah. He's like, see that game last night? Yeah, that was a good one. And you're like, whoa, it's like so long, that guy. But so I don't know. I'd love that scene, the Jim Rome scene too.
All right.
That's sarcastic ball. Let's move on.
And it started a movement to reform the sport, gathering followers by the hundred.
So this is Raising the Bar, which all started because I kept hearing stories about how Disneyland, they've built this new thing at California Adventure called Cars Land. And so it opened, and one of the things that they did was they made all the lines wide enough to fit people on mobility scooters. And what happened was all the people on mobility scooters got pissed off because they didn't anymore have their own separate line. It used to be if you were fat enough to be on a mobility scooter, you could go to the line and say, hey, I'm on a mobility scooter, and they'd put you in this like shorter line that was made for people on scooters. And now they've so many people are taking advantage of that, and in fact showing up, and I guess they go to Disneyland and they have a certain amount of mobility scooters a day for rent that people, all the fat people and people that even weren't that fat that need to walk around some more. But they go and they find a mobility scooter, and then they think they've got it made because they don't have to walk, they can be fat, and they get shorter lines. And so they did this Cars Land thing, and they made the lines purposely so that people on mobility scooters have to stand in line with everyone else. And apparently they were just fucking furious. And I just thought that was so funny. So we just started talking about the idea of people on mobility scooters, and especially the ones that are so aggressive at like Walmarts and stuff like that, that just, you know, really think they're handicapped and really think you should get out of their way because they're on a mobility scooter. And that's where it really all came about.
And Cartman, of course, being that person who would do it in the wrong way.
Yeah.
It's like mobility scooters were supposed to help some people who are kind of homebound, and, you know, you want to think, like, that's great. That helps them get out. And But then it's just sort of like,
just keeps them fat.
If you are too fat to walk around Disneyland, you don't get to go to Disneyland. Don't go. That's all. Like, if you need a personal mobility scooter for some other reason, go to Disneyland, and, you know, that's cool and stuff. Yeah. But, like, if you're too fat to walk around, you don't get to go.
Yeah.
You don't get to go.
That's part of, that's the shitty part of being real fat. That's Cartman, basically.
So we had all that, and then we added in the Honey Boo Boo stuff. I had seen Honey Boo Boo on the, before her own show, on the other pageant stuff, and then we started talking about it, and it was funny because Honey Boo Boo was actually airing on our night, on Wednesday nights, and was beating us in the ratings.
It was like beating us in the ratings. It just was this weird thing where then it was, that's how I actually found out. I didn't even know what Honey Boo Boo was until I saw it on some email that we were losing in the ratings of this thing called Honey Boo Boo, and then we started watching it. And so then we had this whole, like, we just love this idea. There's this meta part of the show where Cartman is obviously pissed off that Honey Boo Boo's beating him in the ratings. That's in there too.
And then of course James Cameron raising the bar, just because that whole thing when he went down in that trench just made us laugh so hard. And I remember when he was doing that, which was like a year or more ago, we were talking about how funny it would be if he went down there and found some old diving gear or something, or found something like showing that other people had been down there, and what would he do? And then we decided to make it Randy Newman.
If it would be, if you knew, if you really had a lot of money and a lot of, it would be really cool to know that James Cameron was going down there and spend whatever money you could to put something down there to make it look, just to fuck with James Cameron once he got down there. Yeah. Those little aquarium scuba guys. Little treasure with a clam with little bubbles coming up.
Yeah, cool.
You're made to feel different. To feel like less of a person.
So this show, Insecurity, is kind of interesting because it was one show that actually came out of meetings for the video game. We spent like the whole summer before this part of the run working on the video game and working on the story for that. And one idea we came up with was having to get into people's homes and get past their security systems. And that really got us talking about all the home security system things and how really it's kind of just a big scam, because it's so rare that a house alarm is going off because of an actual emergency. And then we talked to our friend Chris, who's a policeman, saying that basically, yeah, they get false alarms all the time and are getting called by the security companies to get sent out to places. And so we actually just decided to turn it into a show. And this was I remember we had a bunch of scenes of this one, too, before the run started. We thought this is what we were going to start the run with, but then we just didn't quite have enough of it figured out.
We just had a lot of the Cartman back and forth with the guy. We had all the jokes about the passwords, and we had a lot of that, like, big, you know, montage middle part.
Yeah. And it was another one we kept fighting over, maybe breaking it up into two pieces, because we had this whole piece where the little, you know, with Ike thinking that his mom's fucking the postman and having this whole thing about Amazon and how people will just, because I do it all the time. I'll go to my office and something's arrived from Amazon and I have no memory. I'll like open it. It's like, but it makes it like Christmas every day, because I just get a package from Amazon. I have no idea what's inside, and I'll open it, and then I'll remember. I'll be like, oh yeah, right. I got that thing, which I do the most on like Tuesday nights when we're just approving animation like crazy. It's like 3 a.m. I'll just get on the computer and start ordering shit on Amazon and have no idea. Just to make Thursday like Christmas. And my office is still just filled with empty Amazon boxes.
Trey's office has so many boxes from Amazon.
But it was another one of those things where it was like, we almost felt like we had two shows. And we, for a long time, were thinking, oh man, we should split up and do the whole security, Cartman security system show, and we should do the postman show. And then
we were going to go to the UPS. We were going to go to Amazon. I mean, it kind of goes back to what we talked about a few episodes ago, that we felt like it kind of made sense when the guy from Maine, they're like, oh, well, you know, you the guy at the bar, basically their element of convenience of you know, like that theme of like, hey, you know, it used to, guy was a time when, you know, you went out and got stuff. Now Amazon makes our life easier and they bring everything to your house and stuff. And eventually they'll fuck your wife. You know, if you want to just not do anything, like you don't want to protect your house and you don't want to provide for your family, well, then, you know, you don't get a. And that felt like the two stories sort of had at least a common. They weren't totally different. They kind of.
That's what we thought.
It kind of still feels like.
Then we got to Act 3 and we're like, maybe not.
It kind of makes sense.
We were done by then.
It kind of makes sense.
All right, cool.
Hey, Gerald, sorry, but the UPS man is bagging your wife.
So this is Going Native, which forever we'd been wanting to do a Hawaii show. I have a vacation house in Hawaii, and I've had it forever, since we started South Park, really. So I've always wanted to do something with that and do something with Hawaii, but we just kind of never really figured it out.
We've almost done this like 10 times.
Yeah, we were going to have Jimmy. I remember one, for a long time it was going to be a Jimmy surf show that ended up becoming that that one with the can't.
Lake Tardikaka.
Yeah, Lake Tardikaka. But then we've kind of finally had this idea, you know, based on thinking about if we started it, like there's an episode of Star Trek, the old Star Trek called Amok Time, where Spock is basically just kind of in heat because he has to get back to his home planet and hook up with this girl. And so we just thought that'd be fun to, at least, if nothing else, we'd have Butters all pissed off at everybody, which would be cool.
Yeah, and then we kind of, we looked at a lot of like, well, that's why it's called Going Native, the going Native movie kind of form, which is like, I guess most, the biggest one recently is Avatar.
Yeah.
You know, so we tried to put that on this whole thing of like, well, they go to Hawaii, but the natives are like white people who sort of like have timeshares and stuff there. But it was really hard to, we thought that was really funny that like, yeah, these white people that just like, they've lived there for 5 years and so now they can look down upon all the tourists, you know. It was actually really hard to figure out exactly what, you know what I mean? We knew who we were talking about, but to make the language work, and we really were tripped up because it would have been perfect if we could have said timeshare, but we had done this Aspen. Yeah. We'd done a big timeshare show before, so we didn't want to say that again, so.
Yeah, because it was like, well, were we talking about white people that have been there for generations, or are we talking about just white people that have been there for less than 5 years, or like it was.
Yeah, like, or, and I mean, it sort of made it, yeah, when you say it makes sense, it was just hard to like completely.
Well, then we just decided it was really more about just at least that thing that everyone could identify with, which is sort of like you go anywhere, and if you've been there a week and some people show up, you're just kind of like, oh God, they don't even know what they're doing. That's over here, and this is over there. And you said, you know, we all have that human instinct to suddenly take ownership of.
Yeah, this is my place.
You know, it's like, oh come on, I've been to Hawaii like 10 times. I'm basically Hawaii.
Oh, you still go there to eat?
Ugh, yeah.
You know.
Well, you're just.
I remember when I was like that. Yeah, 1 year ago.
Yeah. You probably think
Butters seems somehow. Was there Hey, yeah, oh, they're 10. Because he and then we used a little bit of what's that place called? Cocoa Palms?
Yeah.
Cocoa Palms, which is actually where that Elvis movie was shot, wasn't it?
Yeah, some of it they shot there. And for our people it's a very private matter. And it's really cool place in Kauai, and it's all still just a big pile of rubble because no one knows what to do with it.
Yeah.
That's really all. You can tell we don't have anything interesting to talk about with this.
No.
So let's move on.
Fuck. No.
I don't want him to go, Stephen. He's too young.
So part of this, actually, some of the idea for this show actually came the year before. I remember we were working on Broadway Brodown, and it was the season before this, and it was Halloween time, too. We kind of came up with this idea of doing a thing about Blockbuster and how no one uses it anymore, so maybe you do like a Shining thing, and I think we even talked about some of the FaceTime stuff, but then it happened to be the week too that then Bobby Lopez, our collaborator from Book of Mormon, came to, you know, work on a show with us just for the fun of it, and we decided, oh, let's do a musical thing. We did Broadway Brodown, so it kind of got put on the back burner, and it got to be Halloween time again this year, and we were like, oh yeah, what about that idea with the Blockbuster and kind of the Shining reference? And we knew full well that Simpsons had done a big Shining parody, and so, but they've done everything.
Yeah, everybody's done a Shining parody. Yeah. We worried about that a little bit. Like, really, we're going to do a Shining parody, but it's just so perfect.
And it was just
incredible.
We thought at least it was a whole new take with the Facebook thing, or I mean the FaceTime thing, and the idea that it was a Blockbuster, and so
And then we were talking about that FaceTime thing. I think, I don't know how that came up. I mean,
I remember originally they were going to go to the Stanley Hotel because that hotel that Stephen King was writing about in The Shining is up in Estes Park, not, you know, sort of in the middle of Colorado, too.
And then Stan had to be on FaceTime, basically.
Yeah, because
they were on
took
vacation
there,
or whatever.
Yeah.
That's how we.
But then we came up with the whole Blockbuster video idea, which is just, it is kind of like, I guess just because we did this show, but I definitely have noticed now two or three like spooky, deserted Blockbuster videos sitting somewhere empty on a corner and just like, you know, because it's going to take so much money to turn it into something else, because it's like when a Pizza Hut goes deserted, you know, it's like, well, what are you going to turn it into? You have to totally redo the building.
About a week or two after we did this episode, I saw a friend of mine I grew up with, and he lives down in Orange County, And he was like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know, I stopped by Blockbuster the other day, da-da-da-da-da-da. I was like, wait, what? Blockbuster? And I don't even, like, they don't even cross my radar. And he says, yeah, it's a lot better than Netflix because they can do the, he gave me this whole spiel about how he still goes to Blockbuster and stuff. And I was like, man, I didn't know. I mean, that's like, I guess some people still do it, but.
But yeah, we definitely had a hard time coming up with at the end of it. I remember we knew we wanted it to end with Stan doing FaceTime as some big costume, you know, the joke right. of getting it to the point where he was in a disguise as it. But I remember on Tuesday actually before we had to, on the day we had to finish, we were just like, we went from Frankenstein to Grim Reaper to like
right.
all these different
Jack the Ripper
like yeah. all these different ideas, and we're because we just thought, well, Frankenstein's too easy, and then,
it was also hard to make it look good with the FaceTime.
Yeah,
they remember it was like to
so
make
then
it
we
look
just right. like decided all that, and then we had the idea we needed to see a few other kids in costume, and as one of the costumes we're like, oh, let's do the Gangnam Style guy because that was big right then, and that's when we're like, oh, let's just use that and do Gangnam Style.
We thought that was pretty sweet.
That's what happens on Tuesday. Like, well,
you think Gangnam Style is fucking
that
sweet?
That might not be sweet, but it's sweet enough for Tuesday.
Just sweet enough. Oh, I get it. And that is just sweet enough for now. So let's move on.
Nobody rents movies anymore.
This is Scars for Applause. Yeah. And this is obviously our Lance Armstrong episode about Lance Armstrong, but not at all. And I don't know, we just came up with this idea. We're just talking about Lance Armstrong, that idea of Jesus, of you know, they're watching the way people reacted to Lance Armstrong's kind of fall from grace and his defenders. And it really was, it's just sad, like somebody who is like your hero and then the ultimate hero being Jesus, like, you know, like that's how it came up of it becomes almost like, you know, like the defenders of Lance Armstrong in the face of like impossible evidence, just being like, you know, you just can't, you're never going to like turn on Jesus. You know, you can't turn on your hero like that.
When we had this idea to do a show about yellow wristbands, actually like a year or two ago, when before any of that.
Oh, we had a long time,
yeah,
longer than that,
a
long time ago.
Where it was just like, we were going to do the kids obsessed with wristbands and wearing things, you know, and that defining them and whether they had yellow or pink for this or whatever. And we just kind of never did that idea. So then when we actually did this episode about a week after the big final bit of press was coming out about the definitive proof against Lance Armstrong and everything. And so it was just like, we started talking about the wristbands again, and it was just like, you know, obviously the parallel of what would Jesus do wristbands.
Right.
And so it was one of those shows
people,
where
I feel like there is something in the fact that they're both wristbands. There's the talisman kind of like, I'm wearing this, and it's like the same reason. You wear them for the same reason, which is like to give yourself, like, it's just weird that the fact that they're both little rubber wristbands or bracelets, at least, I guess.
This is one of those shows where we had, by Thursday, we kind of had the big idea of it, of just like that we were going to, you know, make everyone think we're doing a thing about Lance Armstrong, but it's actually going to be about Jesus and everyone cutting off those wristbands. And and then we kind of started talking about going to visit the factory where the people make all the wristbands. And we first just talked about it being a little bit seussical and you know, maybe just somewhat looking like that. And the more we thought about it, we're like, it really sounded like a Seuss kind of thing. And we're like, oh, maybe it's if you wear a cause on your wristband, it's called a scause and all that stuff. And the rhyme just sort of came and they got drawing on all the Dr. Seuss stuff immediately because, of course, that took forever.
Yeah. That stuff looks great. They did such a good job with that stuff. Yeah. That looks really cool. Uh-huh. Is that enough? Should we move on?
I don't know what else to say.
Yeah, that's cool. Jesus name whenever it comes up.
This is our big. We realized before the run started, we looked at the calendar and realized that, oh wow, we're going to have another episode that airs the day after a big election. Because that had happened 4 years ago when we did a show called About Last Night, where Obama got elected for the first time. And so we sort of banked on Obama getting elected then, and we kind of had it that we could go the other direction if he didn't get elected, but not very easily, and we were going to have to, like, it was going to be a big mess, but we were pretty confident Obama was going to win, and he did. This year came, and it was just even more like, whatever. We, like, didn't even really come up with a backup plan, because it just...
Yeah, we had Mitt Romney drawn.
Yeah.
The first time, when we did it 4 years ago, people were like, you know, wow, that's incredible. How did you, you know, you like you must have done double the work. You did, you know, you did this. And like, no, man, we just read where the polls were. We looked at the smart guys. Like
Went to VegasOdds.com because Vegas Odds.
In Trade, exactly Nate right. Silver, who, you know, and there's other guys like him. And it just is like we just made a really easy bet. Like, you know, it's okay, there's a 95% chance. Well, then let's just bet on that side. You know, and we did the same thing. We did the same thing this year. But it was hard because remember, we also talked about doing like a sequel to The About Last Night.
Yeah.
Because that definitely established like Obama as a character with a certain, you know, want and need. But then, we came up with this.
Because this one was more, we didn't want it to center around the president again. We wanted it to just be our characters.
Right.
And so, but then of course what happened that week was all the news came out about Lucas selling Star Wars rights to Disney, which at least to me was way more important than any of the election coverage and of that news. So I was just like, you know, write what you care about.
That's what you're really passionate about.
And, but we were giving interviews for Book of Mormon, doing some random things this week because it was our last week in the office. And we were telling people, like, you know, they're like, well, you're doing a show where Obama wins. You know, what if he loses? We're like, oh, we're in television. And actually we get to find out a week ahead of time who wins. And Obama, is that going to win? You know, and no one seems to. And we even called the show Obama Wins, 4 days before the election. And it got out. But it's so funny because thinking that it would, you know, people would. 4 years ago when we did that, people were like, whoa, did you see what they did? How'd they do that? How'd they know? And this year people were just like, meh. Could have been a funnier show.
I had friends that were mad that we called Obama Wins. Just not mad, but they were just like, dude, do not fucking curse it. You know, they thought like, oh my, you know, you're asking to, you know. That's what I thought was funny. For the record, I kind of think maybe the Disney thing is going to be good. I think they're going to make better.
Well, it can't be worse.
You know, once you get Lucas out of Star Wars, it could be good. You know, you think about a real director and a couple of real
writers. If they get someone back
I think everyone had the first, because we have our Mickey character, so we also wanted to just play with that, which is like too rich. But I think everyone had the first, like, when you heard that news, you're like, wait, what, fucking Disney? Oh, no. And then you went, oh, no. Actually,
yeah, no, because I think as long as they get someone in there that cares about the mythology of it again, and it sounds like that guy that they're talking about, the guy that wrote Toy Story 3, that's who they're talking about, right? And he seems like a talented guy, so it might be true that it's probably a good thing. It was just funnier for the show to make it not a good thing. But we want to thank everyone for watching all these and listening
for suffering through our talks.
And
I can't wait to do this again next year. Can you wait?
I can't wait until Obama's elected again and we can do it all again. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Promise not to tell anyone.
Oh, boy, it's commentary time.
Hi, everybody. We're back.
This is Trey.
This is Matt. We're doing more mini commentaries, or commentary minis, as we like to call them, for season 13.
Which is the season we're actually still in right now. As we're doing this, we're finishing the last episode of season 13.
Yes.
So, of course, we don't know what it's about yet because it's only Friday. So we decided to do some commentary for the rest of the season.
Yeah, now we've caught up with the DVDs, so now we have to do the commentaries.
Get to do the
commentaries. We get to enjoy doing the commentaries the same time. We're actually the same season we're doing the show. And I predict soon we'll have to do the commentaries before we do the show.
Yes.
We'll have to comment on the show before we even do the show.
So I remember this episode just being, it was right around the time that the Jonas Brothers movie was coming out, and we really had no idea who the Jonas Brothers were. So unfortunately we had to go and watch a lot of them on YouTube and definitely nothing new, you know, boy band stuff. It wasn't like it was this crazy new thing. But the thing we did find really weird was their whole thing about purity rings and how that was kind of, that people that were talking about purity rings and all that were also shooting little girls in the face with hot foam, with hot white foam.
But it's a really good idea. It's like have a boy band, but make them parent safe.
Yep.
That was the, you know, purity ring thing. So we started kind of, I remember this episode, we really talked about like, just kind of how screwed up that is to like use sex, the sex appeal of the Jonas Brothers to sell non-sex, and how they're kind of like, I don't know, turning on little girls to sell non-sex. But we kind of thought, we thought our way there. We never heard of this actually happening. Does that make, you know what I mean? Like, we deduced it.
Right.
But then, like, the day before the show came out, we started hearing stories, because then the movie had come out, and then we started hearing reports of little girls at movie theaters talking about how their ginies tickled when they watch the show, when they watch the movie, which is pretty great.
And that, it ended up in the show because there was one person who worked at for the network that was basically that said that she had taken her daughter to see it, and her daughter said, "Mommy, my giny tickles."
Her 8-year-old daughter.
And we were like, "That is so going in the show." We were so excited.
And it was like
that.
That's they really were hitting girls below the belt, so to speak. That's where they were trying to appeal to them. Which is pretty, you know what, I'm going to say it, it's fucked up.
Yeah.
It's just fucked up. And then a lot of people think we made up the foam thing, but go on YouTube, they have these big cannons and they shoot foam on girls' faces, and then the great part is the girls love it.
Yeah.
I don't know why, I don't know what that makes me think of, and then they grow up loving it even more and more. And now it's unbelievable how Jonas Brothers are corrupting the young girls of America. But this also, we had a big, remember we had kind of an argument about like which show we should do first, because we were talking about the economy.
Yeah.
Kind of like, oh, maybe we should do the economy first. And that was on that side. I thought we should do this economy episode first. And Trey thought we should do the Jonas Brothers episode first. And his reasoning was sound. It was, well, it's funny.
Right.
And you're right.
And we had it kind of figured out.
Yeah, and it turned out to be a great first episode to do, that kicked us off in a good way.
Except that we had to listen to a lot of Jonas Brothers music, and so we could, you know, copy their songs, and that was pretty brutal.
Yeah. And the fun part was, I think when we started wanting to do this episode, it's like we were screwing around in the writer's room, we're doing a Mickey Mouse voice, kicking like a mean Mickey Mouse.
Yeah.
And it was the idea of doing at the end of everything. That's kind of when it started being like, okay, yeah, we could do this. It's an episode. That's pretty fucking funny.
Cool. So, yeah. That's that.
How much is that? Did we get there? How many minutes is that? Good. Let's move on to the next one.
Yeah, we don't have any more to say about that. Let that near your penis? What?
Woohoo!
So, this episode, the Coon sort of started out as a whole Watchmen thing, where we were going to have all the kids in costumes and We figured out Cartman's character first, which was going to be the Coon, and you know, he was always just way more into making sure people knew who he was than about fighting crimes. And then as we were trying to get into the other kids and we're going through drawings of who the other kids would be, Cartman just sort of took over the entire show. And then finally we just said, let's forget it. Let's just make it Cartman doing this, which was probably a good idea.
Yeah.
But we were able to keep Butters in there, and then we had Mysterion. And Mysterion's just another one of those things, like, who's Cartman's dad, where, you know, everyone wants to ask us who is Mysterion. And we don't know.
We don't know. We never figured it out. I actually kind of forgot about it.
But we had right up until the end, this show had a different ending on it, which is right now Mysterion just reveals who it is and everyone goes, oh. And then, of course, the joke is all South Park kids look the same if you don't have their hat on. So you don't know who it is. But then it had an ending where Kyle was in jail.
Oh, that's right.
It was revealed that it was Kyle, and they're like, "You're going to jail, Coon or Mysterion." And then it cut to the jail, and Kyle was in there, so you knew that Kyle was Mysterion. But then, in the last few frames, Mysterion shows up
and
says, "Why did you do that for me?" And Kyle says, "Because I know who you are, and I think you have to keep doing what you're doing." So, and then we realize, well, that's spending a lot of time just to eliminate Kyle, which doesn't really help all that much. And so just for the sake of time, we ended up cutting that out.
Yeah, I remember that. It was a good, like, back and forth, comic book back and forth. What was it? And then it kind of turned into a Dark Knight thing, just kind of ripping on the whole, like, when... It's now comic books have to be, like, with the Dark Knight and with Watchmen is, like, trying to be serious and heavy instead of too cartoony.
No.
Which I think is good. Compared to like the old Batman.
Yeah,
stuff.
It's cool. But it's just, and then Watchmen came, it's like for some reason.
But it's like everyone has to talk
like that. Which is the same as like 20, it's the same as Jack Bauer in 24.
Yeah, it's like,
what? Telling you something's going on here.
It's gotta be whispering and like you've been up all night smoking.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I mean, Dark Knight's just retarded how he just keeps talking like that. I mean, that doesn't make any sense. And then Christian Bale just forgot he wasn't Batman in Terminator Salvation, just kept talking like that. I'm convinced Christian Bale just talks like that now from now on. Is there anything else in this episode? Oh, you know what else in this episode? There's one of my favorite jokes. Is the stupid. No, I'm just over here now. Well, I've whittled it down to three people, and it's Cartman and what's his name? The fat gay.
Bruce Valanche.
Bruce Valanche.
We actually got a card from Bruce Valanche thanking us.
Bruce Valanche thanked us, which is so nice.
Yeah.
I thought that joke was really funny. All right. Well, that's the coon. I'm right here now. Is anything else about this episode? Did we do 4 minutes on this?
Oh, wait, no. Right, that was never it. 4 minutes.
Yes, it's not even 4 minutes?
No.
Oh, man.
If
no,
we had good. Other stuff to say, we would. There's a box. All your men get a look at these, detective. And there's a window. All right. Move on.
Let's move on.
So this is Margaritaville, and this is one of what we like to call a complete head fucker show. It's one of those shows that you just keep talking about because it's so kind of conceptual that, you know, when you get it, it's one of those things where we just kept talking around it and around it and trying to figure out what it was. And we had this idea for a long time that, you know, how the economy is really like religion and how it's all based on faith. And if you have faith in it, it exists. And if you don't, it doesn't. And all this stuff. And it had like, I'm sure that there's a version of this show somewhere that's like an hour and a half long because we went to whole versions of trying to explain that, you know, philosophy and everything. And then, as usual, we cut it all way back and just kept all the funny stuff in. But it was definitely very philosophical on our stupid little level for a while.
Yeah, we had to talk about it a lot to figure out how to make it line up with the Jew, the young Jew who's being heretical, I guess, would be who's saying these crazy things, right?
That God is good, basically.
That God is good and the Romans being like the town, right?
Yeah.
Way out of our league with the biblical stuff. Luckily, we have Ann Garfino to help us with our Bible studies. But then I think it was like, we knew it was, I think for a long time, we talked about it for a long time. As I said, we talked about doing this episode first because it was kind of like, we had been gone for 3 or 4 months. The economy was
the
shitter.
Big news.
That's what everyone was talking about. That kind of it affected everyone's life, directly or indirectly. And so it's like it made sense to, I don't know, to get it right. But we had that part. We had the economy only works if you have faith in it. And then we had this idea of ripping on Margaritavilles and how just stupid margarita makers are, and the idea of like stupid appliances that just have one use. You know, like,
and which came, we, I had personal knowledge of that because I do have a Margaritaville.
And my aunt has a Margaritaville.
I had like a party, an outdoor party one summer, like 2 summers ago, and I bought a Margaritaville.
I remember that, yeah.
And it's pretty stupid because it really is a blender.
It just is a blender. My aunt has a Margaritaville, and we had Christmas or Thanksgiving last year up in Colorado, and my aunt and uncle live in Texas, and they drove up. And they brought their Margaritaville in the back of their car just in case anybody wanted a margarita. Just in case, like, we wouldn't be able to get a margarita in Colorado or make a good one. So she drug up this stupid thing and never got used. Actually, we did use it one night and it didn't work.
And now they've got ones that are like 3 Margaritaville, like, so that it's 3 blenders all next to each other. So you can make like strawberry margaritas in one or whatever. Like, so dumb.
So stupid. And so the Margaritaville was just the, obviously, the stupid metaphor for America's bought a bunch of shit that it doesn't need.
That's what I do.
Yeah, I mean, that's what everyone does. But it's also like, I don't know, we kind of felt like we didn't want to make an episode that was like, oh, those Wall Street guys took our money, you know what I mean? Or like, it's kind of one of those things that it was more like we all kind of screwed up.
Like, nobody really knows what's going on.
And nobody knows what really is going on, but that it has something to do with buying shit like Margaritavilles.
Yeah.
You know, at the heart of it, there's something just like if you have enough money where you're buying Margaritavilles and all of a sudden you don't have enough money where you can't maybe buy a Margaritaville, it's like, who the fuck cares?
You know what I remember now is that this was going to be the coon. We were going to do this whole episode with the coon, and he was solving the economy.
Well, because the beginning of the coon has a bad economy part.
Right. And so it used to be even more skewed towards that, and it was him, it was the coon was going to solve the economy.
He was going to cure the economy.
But he found out that Jimmy Buffett was making these margaritas.
Oh, that's
Buffett
right.
Was going to be the enemy.
The evil Buffett brothers. It was Warren Buffett and Jimmy Buffett.
And they never knew they were brothers.
He never knew until now.
See, that's why he becomes a head fucker, because he just starts talking about all this in all these different ways.
Yeah. And the hard part, then it was a hard... this shot, isn't this the longest shot in South Park?
Probably.
I think this shot right here.
I think we might have just beat it, actually, because
with the new episode.
We just did an episode where there's a kid on the intercom dying on the
that
morning announcement.
The shot.
I think that's longer than this.
But when this was done, this is the longest shot in South Park history until this
until
point.
That.
Somebody told me that. The hard part was trying to figure out how to make that whole stand story work also, going up through things, so that it kind of made sense enough so people made it look like we were kind of smart, but obviously it's not really literally smart, but we wanted to follow like the subprime crisis from Orange County to Wall Street to the Fed and go up the ladder instead of down, Stan was supposed to be doing, and to try to make that work kind of, we asked my dad for help, who's an economist. So that was
that's right. We were chasing that dialogue for a long time. Like, that was one of those things where Tuesday night we're still just rewriting all that dialogue. When they're explaining to Stan, here's what happened, like, then we're just honing in and honing in, going, this is really the closest to what happened. So
right. And close enough for us for to make the jokes work and everything.
Yeah.
So that was nice that my dad was an economist to help us out. Don't have to talk to anybody other than family. And then the other thing is when this episode is done, and even then we decided to submit it for the Emmy. You know, when we want an Emmy with this episode, and you have to choose which episode you want to submit,
which is dumb,
but that's just the way it works. And we can put down the Emmys anymore and stop winning Emmys, just keep putting it down. when we decided to submit this for the Emmy, we kind of did it because we'd gotten so much positive feedback. And it sounds corny, but especially from like older people, like older viewers, people our age and older. We don't know how it went over with kids, and we kind of figured Emmy voters weren't a bunch of kids; they were older people. So we said, oh, you know, if an Emmy voter was to watch us, they might think the show was smarter than it was as a season. So they might be fooled into voting for us.
It was this or Queef Sisters. I really wanted to submit Queef Sisters. I thought that was a lot more poignant for our time.
But it worked, so we won. And the other thing is, I mean, with the second we were done with this episode, Trey and I thought it was, especially the just, I mean, I think there's a lot of great writing in it, but the third act
it's not
just
good.
Is junky because junky. The two stories stay completely separate and they don't cross, and that just bugged us, and we ended up just kind of giving up on it and going, all right, that's good enough. And everyone else seemed to really like it, and we won an Emmy.
It was one of those where sort of the concept of it kind of saw it through, but I give the concept on this an A, and the execution like a C minus.
Yeah, and the third act.
It's not like Queef Sisters where it's concept A, execution A.
Concept A plus. Queefs, B plus.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know what else we can say about Margaritaville.
That was pretty long.
How long was that? Okay. Good enough. All right, on to the next show.
I can't wait to comment on the next one. And thou knowest that thou stockbrokers did not fear the economy. So this is our episode that should have won the Emmy, but it lost to Margaritaville.
It lost before it was even nominated.
No one would let me nominate this because we definitely wouldn't have won. But
there's just a whole lot of queefs going on in this episode.
Just all queefs. This is my favorite, by far my favorite show of the run. I've seriously never laughed as hard in retake, like doing, you know, shot by shot and just sitting there in the editing room, like laughing. And then it was so great because we would always, all the dudes would be in there just cracking up, and then we'd turn around and all the women that work on the show are kind of just hanging in the back, like just straight faced, and it made me laugh even harder. So it's like, definitely. Yeah.
There's like, I remember doing the, doing Queef Sisters. There's like moments when you're doing a stupid TV show where it really strikes you how stupid your job is. And one is like, we're doing the queefs and they're jumping up and queefing each other's face. You're like, yep, like, this is, I have the dumbest job in the world.
This is dumber than Terrence and Phillip. It's amazing.
It's just really stupid. But it's, I can't remember the other storyline in this. What's the boys?
Well, the boys is just that the one girl queefs on Butters.
I forgot about that.
It's a queefing with a queefing beeline. But it was going to start. Queef Sisters originally was going to be we were just going to do Queef Sisters special, just like we did Terrence and Phillip.
That's right.
And we were like, oh, wouldn't that be funny? Because it just so happened that April 1st was landed on this run, just like it did back in the day when we did a Terrence and Phillip special instead of Who's Carmen's Father that went over so well. So we're like, let's do it again, but let's do it with Queef Sisters. And they were like, well, no, I guess this time we will work the boys into it.
Now somewhat. The boys had it done to them.
Yeah.
In the show.
But it was literally going to be this, just like what you're seeing right now. It was going to be this for 30 minutes, just a bunch of them queefing, which I still totally want to make that show because I'd be the only person that would like it.
The sideways thing in here is really funny, where they go cruising in Canadian
water. Oh, yeah, yeah.
That was fun.
But yeah, it was pretty fun because obviously we're just having the boys be everyone's reaction to Terrence and Phillip. But then it was the whole thing.
I remember too in the writers' room we were doing the frontward queef fart thing, and all the women in the writers' room like, man, I don't know if that's funny. Yeah. We kept farting out of our fronts, kind of like queefing.
And we kept saying in the room too, and the people were like, oh, and then what it should be is that queefing really takes off, and then the women really get into it, and the women are like, why would they do that? They wouldn't get into it.
That's the funny part. Yeah.
But this was the first scene that we had. Was and it was for a while it was just this scene without the boys in it, and then we sort of edited and then we had the idea of like, oh, maybe the boys go home and watch this,
And so then it was all them watching it and reacting to it, which obviously was probably better, but there's some queef impurity. I would love just to have more queef sisters.
The queef sisters. I guess
so. What the hell is this disgusting crap?
But there's actually the scene where they're sitting at Stan's house and Stan's mom just kind of queefs, and Randy's like, what was that? Like, that series, I love, it's because it's like, it's another show. It's not South Park. It's totally not South Park timing or anything like that.
It's like realism timing.
And Stan's just like, stop it, mom. It's more like, you know.
It's a Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Yeah, it's like that kind of timing. It's really weird.
The Office or something. Yeah. It's just much more naturalistic than anything we usually do.
It's just a lot. This show's a lot better writing than most shows. It's just really brilliant.
The Queef Sisters.
All right, cool. We're going to move on. Show that smut instead of the Terrence and Phillip conclusion, you
asshole! Our Fish Sticks episode. This fish episode, sticks. It was another thing that started just that we had no idea what it could be. And all we had was the scene where Kanye West was being interviewed by the news guy, and the news guy is going, do you like fish sticks?
Yeah.
And that's all we had, and we had no idea like how we were going to get there or what the joke was. And then one day we kind of just worked our way around into it from the back. But it happened because we were doing a writer's retreat in Seattle, and I had taken everyone to see where the salmon jump. And we were sitting there watching the salmon jump, and for some reason decided that Kanye West was a salmon.
I know exactly what happened. We were watching the salmon jump, and then we were talking about, somehow we got joking about a little salmon with an Evel Knievel costume on.
Yeah,
and like, then he's Evel Knievel, and he'd be like, oh, the best salmon that joined. And then we start talking about that Kanye West video where he pretended to be Evel Knievel jumping over Snake River, and then we were joking about that, and then it was like fish dicks somehow came out. That was like Kanye West is a fish and fish dicks.
He's a gay fish. And
gay fish,
he likes
and somehow
fish
dicks and fish sticks and fish dicks.
But at first, because for a while it was just going to be Kanye West is a fish. And then he was going to be like, no, I am not a salmon.
Yeah. And it was like, just somebody says, do you like fish dicks? And it was like, And then we just went off on that for like 4 hours. Yeah.
I remember the whole car ride back from there to my place. The
driver.
In Seattle, it was just like,
this van driver we hired to take us there was just so bummed on us.
Just in the time of fish
dicks. Fish dicks. Hey, you're a gay fish. Fish dicks. You're a gay fish. Fish dicks. Over and over, we thought it was so fun, and just the fact that he didn't get it, and it seemed to fit with, you know, at first it was like, why, this has, it was absolutely, when we first came up with it, it was absolutely absurdist, had nothing to do with Kanye West at all.
It wasn't then, like, let's rip on Kanye West.
It wasn't like, yeah, it was just stupid. It was just because the Evel Knievel costume was kind of remind us. But then the more we started joking about it, it was like, well, Kanye West would be the most humorless person in the world about this and wouldn't get the joke. So then it started sticking. And then when we started thinking about making an episode, which we kind of avoided for a long time because it just seemed too dumb. Are we really going to do a whole episode about this? We kind of made it as a... Cartman in this episode is like a few people we've worked with over our career. In that they sit around with you while you're working and then take credit for what you did.
And truly, believe they had something to do with it.
Believe that they did it. And, and that's the really sinister part is it isn't like, oh, they're trying to steal... part of the glory, like this was our work and they didn't do anything. It's like they actually fully believe that they came up with it. And that's Cartman in this episode.
Yeah.
He can do anything but sit on the couch and eat chips.
Hey Mackie, do you like fish sticks?
Everyone's just so stoked on this joke.
But then the craziest thing was that we were like, there's definitely some people going, oh, you know, Kanye, he's the kind of guy that like hires people, he's gonna like hire people to kick your ass or what's his reaction going to be, this or that? And it was crazy because the next day on his blog, it was all Kanye saying, basically like, well, South Park really made fun of me last night and it made me realize I really do need to look at myself and I really do. And it was shocking.
It was
really
unexpected,
like,
unexpected reaction.
It's like, that's really, it was like, dude, we just said you're a gay fish. Like, what are you talking about? Like, it's so dumb. But this was before Kanye did the last thing he did on state where he took.
Yeah, he did something else in the meantime. And we just said he kind of doesn't have a sense of humor. We didn't really even. So apparently more and more Americans are eating. And then he kind of did. He kind of said it was funny. Loving fish sticks kind of makes me wonder, We rip on Carlos Mencia. Carlos Mencia gets it much worse than Kanye West.
That's true.
The funny part.
Carlos Mencia should have been way more pissed than Kanye West.
Just a complete afterthought to the whole thing. But then the end was good too. The end of this show is really good, where he jumps in and they traded an auto-tune.
Which is crazy because I hadn't used one of those things before. And so I sang it to it the first time and it didn't make that sound. And I was like, well, how do you make it make that sound? And I realized to make it make that sound, you had to sing off key. Like
you have to be a bad singer.
You have to be a bad singer in order for that thing to actually make sound the way it does. If you use that and you sing into it correctly, it doesn't do anything to your voice. Anyway,
that's funny.
Right.
Yes. Next
Let's
episode.
Move on.
And you like fish sticks?
Yes.
So this is an example of what we call an episode that's too big for its britches.
Didn't work out like quite the way it was supposed to.
Way too big of an idea to try to squeeze into 20 minutes.
Well, this is another idea, but also guys, that got screwed up by The Simpsons.
Yep.
Or by the fact that The Simpsons exists.
Simpsons fucked us on it. We actually had this. We had the idea was originally that Randy finds out that the reason that he's researching why the dinosaurs became extinct, and then he realizes that it... He finds a fossil with a gun, and he realizes that it's when they invented... It was like 400 or 500 years after they invented guns that dinosaurs all killed themselves, and so they realize that we've got no time left unless we get rid of all our guns. So then there's this big thing where the world gets rid of all guns, and then this alien came down with a little pistol, like very gangster style, and was like, yeah, see, everyone get on the ground, right? And
no one had any guns.
No one had any guns, so he took over the world with like a 38. And we were so stoked on this idea. We thought it was so cool. And we were like, literally, we went immediately in animation. We're like, this is an hour special. Because it was at a time we were going to make an hour special.
We were going to make an hour special.
So we're like, this is it. This is our hour special. Let's go. This is sweet. And then I don't remember who it was.
Simpsons did it. And the Simpsons, they did it in a Treehouse Horror. And they did it like, not just, oh, part of that idea, like that entire idea.
Yeah.
And in fact, we talked about, oh, the world gets together and does like a big peace sign rally to show how peaceful they are. And he sees that as a thing. And I think The Simpsons did that exact joke.
Yeah.
And I mean, maybe we saw it and subconsciously, but we thought our whole way there. I didn't think they did the dinosaurs. I don't think they did that. But
I just remember no,
it was just like
no more time in our, I mean, we've always talked about how, you know, when you think you have a good idea and then someone says Simpsons did it, you're like, fuck, you know. But this seriously was the work. Because we had, we were so stoked. We thought it was the sweetest idea and we had an hour special going. And then it was like, someone's like, well, you know, this is like that Simpsons thing. We're like, what do you mean? And we saw it and we're like, oh, fuck. And then
it's exactly the same.
Our friends that work at the Simpsons were over here and we told them this whole story. And they're like, yeah, that's funny. You know, we actually ripped off that idea, too, from ourselves and did it again. They said they did it in another show.
They had forgotten they had done it.
Yeah. I'm like, well, fuck you. And then they were like, what do you guys care? Just fucking do it anyway.
They were like, just do it.
No, can't. So then it just
became... But the part we really liked was the Simpsons didn't do was this idea of this alien coming down with a little revolver and being like, get down on the ground, see? Like an old gangster film. So we thought maybe we'll keep that part and lose the rest, the whole smart first part of it.
Yeah.
And then it just became a bunch of shit, basically.
But then as soon as we came, then we kept talking about it and doing all this, and then it became Space Cops and all this stuff, and it was just like, then it was all the big tech, and it was like, it's another thing. It's just too big of an idea.
It was supposed to be like a simple plan or something where a load of cash falls on Earth and everybody, you know, this previously okay relationship between the world gets screwed up because of greed and done on an intergalactic level. But just when you start trying to map that out logically about who knows what
in 20 minutes,
it just and have it have something to do with our characters and have Randy all of a sudden have to speak for the world. And it's just dumb. It kind of worked. There's some funny shit.
I'm not apologizing for it. This episode's sweet. Fuck you.
But it was like we did kind of meander our way.
I do like all the Pinewood Derby stuff.
Yeah, the Pinewood Derby stuff is funny. There's also, like, we were going to, we did a lot of research about the Pinewood Derby. We saw a lot of kids' photos online with their trophies and stuff. It was a lot of funny. Pinewood Derby's kind of a big thing.
Yeah.
Here we go. Last
All right.
Onward.
In 3, 2, 1, go!
So this show has a kind of funny history, too, because actually, this show was going to be the previous week's show. Because the whole pirate thing, Somalian pirate crisis with that captain being held hostage was going down right then. And so we had started it, because we had this idea, oh, that's funny, you know, pirate, everyone's talking about pirates again, and Carmen should think it, you know, it's those kind of pirates, and kind of came up with the idea and started getting into it and thinking this, oh, this is cool. But then the crisis kept happening.
There was that standoff when the guy was in the boat.
Yeah, the captain, and so... We were sitting there going, well, what if they kill him? And, you know, it's like, if they kill him on Monday and we come out with a show on Wednesday saying how sweet pirates are and making fun of the whole thing, it's not going to be that cool.
We do care sometimes. So we were sitting there. We started animating it, and it got to be Friday afternoon, and still nothing had happened. And we're like, oh, man, we can't. What do we do? This is supposed to air in a week. This guy's still being held captive. It could be killed. Could be fine. Do we just do it, or do we shelve it? And we're like, well, if we shelve it, the only thing we can go to is Pinewood Derby, because it's a show that we have some of it animated to, even though we haven't figured it all out. But this episode, Pinewood Derby, that we've been talking about forever because it was one of those headfucker episodes, it was like, that's our only option, is to go to that. And so we did. We put down Fat Beard, and we went and did Pinewood Derby instead, and then decided we'll wait for a week. And then it was like, what, a day later or something that the guy was fine.
Probably on Wednesday or Thursday, I think.
No, I think it was like Saturday or Sunday, and we're like, oh, can we switch back to Fat Beard? And they're like, no, you can't. Happened, because it was like, then it was too late.
Too late, we couldn't.
And because a show like that, when they're in Somalia, it has so much new modeling in it. So it ended up being the last show, which wasn't a bad thing because it was a good last show.
Yeah, I think it was.
It just basically forced us into doing Pinewood Derby, which we really weren't ready to do.
Couldn't figure out.
We really didn't have it figured out.
We still don't have it figured out. I thought the song in this episode was really fun. I think this might be the first time Cartman says, "The fuck is this?" Isn't it?
Yeah, and we were gonna.
They're just so disappointed.
Yeah.
To me, that sentence, "the fuck is this," that is Cartman in four words.
Yeah.
Because Cartman's entire life, to me, is about getting excited about seeing the brochure for Disneyland, and then getting there, and it's not quite what he, you know, it's never, no place you ever go or get is ever quite as good as what the brochure. This is always like heightened expectations, and then, "the fuck is this?" And just like. That's Cartman. That's Cartman's every day.
Yeah.
And so I think this was the first time we used that. When he gets
so that's the little ginger kid that does the morning announcements that we actually killed this season.
Yeah. This was setting him up brilliantly early on.
We had that all planned out, of course.
You have to watch from here to get what happens. Also, there's this is one of the episodes we decided to have just kind of a weird. A lot of times I think we get too obsessed with tying up catching every ball and making sure everyone gets back to South Park. We used to be much more into, like, early on we'd be like, well, we can't just leave the boys in Mexico, or we'd have to get them back home, remember? And this episode, we just left them in Somalia on the beach because it was the end of the season and it felt like the show was over.
We had an ending to this show that we actually had an animatic and everything where
they all
get shot, and then basically Cartman just started singing and going, well, that was a great season, and then he started inviting everyone back that had made a guest appearance. So like
the Jonas Brothers came in
and Kanye West came in and everything, and it was just like this big weird, for some reason we thought it was like a variety show ending. And then we got it. It was one of those things, where, you know, it happens. You get it there in animatic and you look at it and you're like, okay, let's not do this. So just everyone getting shot and "the fuck is this" became the end, which worked fine.
That's probably good, right? Let's move on to the second half.
And take care you put us in an exit row, you landlubber.
You have been very, very naughty. You're a naughty girl.
Oh, yes, Gerald. I've been so naughty.
So this was, now we're into the second half. So we basically did all those shows before, and then we had a big summer off. Well, not off, because we were working on something else. But we then came back, and this was just about 6 weeks ago now that we were doing this episode. We went and had a few ideas for shows coming into this run, but this one was sort of one of those that suddenly came up, and it sounded like a good idea for a first show, but we sort of thought of it basically right the week before we were airing.
Yeah, it was just that, just right before.
Everyone kept saying, you know, after Michael Jackson died and everything, I was like, oh, you're going to do a big Michael Jackson show, and we were like, well, we already did, and we don't really know what more you could do with it. But then we just started talking about, like, well, how could you do a Michael Jackson show that doesn't actually have Michael Jackson in it, and just hearing
really
him,
isn't really about,
you know,
him.
And then once the idea, someone had the idea of putting him in Ike's body, and that seemed fun.
Yeah, and people were talking about how there was the summer of 2009 was the summer of celebrity deaths. Especially towards the end there, it seemed like it was like...
There were a couple weeks where there were a lot dropping quick, and that's
just
why
like,
it became...
Yeah.
Especially Billy Mays. That hit everyone the hardest, of course.
That was just out of the blue. I mean...
Who'd have thought? The best thing about the Billy Mays one was the fact that he died, and then they said, you know, well, all he did was he hit his head on an airplane coming in, and then the next day he woke up dead. I'm like, what? Like... One of those things where, like, that can happen.
Right.
Like, fuck, you know, I don't want to fly. Like, I don't want to hit my head and die from that, and then it's like, then it came out 2 weeks later, it's like, oh, and he had a bunch of coke in his body, and a bunch of like like 30 different drugs that he had in his body. You're like, okay. And then he hit his head.
And then we were like, oh, that can happen?
Yeah, that, you know, I guess we won't do 30 different drugs anymore.
Ooh,
and hit our heads. Drugs.
Ooh, coke will kill you?
Ooh. But this was a pretty brutal episode. This took us, this is one of those up until 11 in the morning on Wednesday, which usually if we're up till like 7 in the morning, that's a good thing these days. But this was a 11 o'clocker that was pretty brutal.
Now, Ike, your family. What else? The purgatory thing is funny in this. We debated whether to make it a real plane. Or, yeah. Like, that was kind of a hard thing conceptually to figure out, like, how much of a plane it should resemble and how much it shouldn't.
The cool thing was we saw the next day that Billy May's son actually did a big... He came out to the press and said that he actually really liked it and he thought his dad would have really liked it.
Sure.
He's like, my dad yelled at Patrick Swayze. I think that's cool. So that's good.
Anything else? I can't remember anything else.
It's so funny because the show, the sooner that we've, I know, and like the sooner we've done them, the more I'm just completely drawing a blank. We had a scene in this show where they actually went and dug up Michael Jackson. Like, that was part of the big thing was, okay, because Michael Jackson's in Ike's body, they've got to go show Michael Jackson that he's dead so that he'll try to move on.
That's right, yeah.
But then he still wouldn't accept it, so then they were going to dig him, because we're like, oh, then he's going to dig him up because people will be so pissed off.
The boys were going to just drag around Michael Jackson's dead body the whole episode. But
it just didn't, it didn't work for them to be in Colorado and then be out in L.A. and then be over somewhere else for a beauty pageant, and so it ended up.
I think once we're joking around about Michael Jackson and what's somebody say, it was like that thing of like, you're dead and you're dead and you're black. And he's like, no, you're ignorant. It was like that. It was like that was when we were like, okay, this is making a sweet episode.
Yeah, yeah.
Just the fact that he was in denial, that's holding up everything.
But the thing that really made it an episode was when we came up with Chipotle Way.
Yeah, that's right, Chipotle Way. I can't gonna forget that.
And the thing is that what's really funny is like I actually love Chipotle, and it was just another one which happens
people
all the time.
Like,
it was
why,
just a
why that?
Completely random. Just like I think I was probably having Chipotle in the writers' room that day because I really get Chipotle probably once a week in the writers' room, and so and I actually think it's really good.
I got a lot of questions of people saying, "Was that inspired by a real life incident?" I'm like, No, that's what's funny about it. What's funny about it is Chipotle is kind of thought of as healthy fast food.
Yeah.
See, the joke wouldn't work if it was McDonald's or Carl's Jr. or something that was considered shitty.
Right.
It has to be like healthy fast food that makes you bleed out of your ass.
But they are giant. I mean, it is true that if I ate an entire, I usually get like 2/3 of the way through, which is still probably too much, but like.
It's also the whole thing, the joke started too of like how infomercials, that's funny, how infomercials, they create a problem and sell you it.
Yeah.
Like something maybe it doesn't.
Completely don't need.
Yeah, you don't need one of those. You don't need a hat warmer. So, but they'll sell you one. Or Margaritaville.
Yeah.
What? Are you serious? All right. All right, let's move. If there's even a chance that Billy May's soul is not
at rest, then I want to help however I can. So Butter's Bottom Bitch was what we like to call a recovery episode, because Dead Celebrities was so fucking hard on us that this just kind of seemed like a pretty easy thing to do. Like, Butter's being a pimp, that sounds pretty easy. Let's do that.
Sounds like it could be funny.
Yeah.
I mean, this is, I don't know, we started talking about American Pimp, or I can't remember where, how this idea came up, but we love American Pimp. I love that movie.
Yeah.
Or anything about pimps, it fascinates me. Just, and I think it was the idea that the kissing, the girl with a little kissing business, and it really, it, like, was funny to us that that you could organically and naturally present, like, start a little kid story that progressed into a pimp-ho relationship naturally without them ever knowing what pimp-ho, you know, anything about pimps and hoes. But then we really wanted to get Butters dressed up in a little pimp thing, and then he, you know all the lingo. So that's why he had to go to the players' ball and learn all that stuff. But we got to watch American Pimp and Pimps Up, Hoes Down. Remember? What was the other one? There's one other one we watched.
American Pimp and Pimps Up, Hoes Down is the one. I mean, we'd seen them plenty, but
yeah, we had to watch it again.
Go back and check them again, which is, you know, they're what? They're probably 12 years old now.
Yeah, 10 years old. Yeah.
But it's, I guess the game's about the same. The game hasn't changed. The game's still the same. You know what I'm saying?
We talked briefly about trying to get some real pimps to do their voices, but then everyone kind of told us they wouldn't be very reliable, show up on time and stuff.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunately what we need in this job. People show up generally on time. Remember what else is in this episode?
Well, the thing I got the most comments on.
This is seriously a month ago. I can't remember the thing
about 4 weeks ago now.
The thing I got the most comments on was the cop basically shitting cum into an evidence bag.
Yeah, we shouldn't have been able to do that on television.
That was just horrible. But that entire joke of the cop dressing up like a prostitute and then basically being like, I'm gonna go bust guys, and then basically waiting until the whole job was finished to be like, freeze, was like, so we came with that like during Orgasmo.
Yeah, that was
it was like
time
a long time ago. Yeah. And I think it was even gonna be in Orgasmo or something, and then it was just always an idea that we had kind of lingering, that especially for the first 6 years of South Park, which is like, well, you never get that on TV because you got a guy getting.
If we wait long enough, we'll get it all on TV.
Shitting come into a bag. It's like, oh, we can do it now, sure.
Yeah, that shitting come into a bag, I thought was just going to be like, oh, that's a funny little writer's room joke that will never make it in the show. I was like, yeah, okay, we can do it.
Yeah.
We just cut away. We just cut away so you didn't know what it was.
And it was great because we got, for that same scene, like before he does that, we got, at the very last minute, we just decided to try to get a Peaches song for him to dance to. And we were like, that's what always happens too, is like when we want a real song, you know, usually you go through this thing and you want a song and then you got to go clear it and you got to like figure out how much you're going to pay them and they decide, oh, is our song going to be in your show or not? And we always do that on like Tuesday morning at like 9 a.m.
Yeah, and like, we always do it. We do it with artists that are like probably not going to be that stoked. Their songs. And,
yeah.
You know, we do it with different like Andrew Lloyd Webber and stuff like that.
But or, it was cool that that
Peaches
was cool because I'm a huge fan of Peaches. I think she's awesome. So it was cool to put that in.
Yeah, it fit perfectly too. Should we move on? Was that enough for this episode? We can't remember anything. All right, next episode. Drum up some third grade customers. If
you could do kisses before school too. Say that again, Edge. You think you're better than me?
This wrestling show was actually originally going to be the first episode of the run. I'm glad it was, because it would have been equally hard. This was a pretty hard one, too. Just because we didn't even really know what the concept was, except that they...
Well, we just had the concept of wrestling as theater, but that's not that, like, you know, that's not that original. People have come with that. But we just kind of thought the boys doing it and then kind of making actually kind of good theater and getting kind of into it and... I don't know, we just thought it was fun. It seemed like a boy's story that would be organically come out of the whole idea of, like, thinking wrestling's one thing and then having it be another. But when they start playing it, they weren't even really into the fight. I guess they were into the fighting, but they didn't realize how much they were into the drama, much they were into all the stupid drama. That's actually what was the best thing to them. And then we always love those took our jobs hicks, and we never got to bring them back. I think we always wanted to do another show with them.
Well, there was always there's a big cross audience with the WWE and South Park people. The only WWE stuff we've seen, which isn't much, is a lot of times they have South Park stuff there too.
It was kind of but then we thought that what if sometimes I think we were in the writers' room, we were saying like, oh, and then like you know, Carmen does this and that and the other, and like to make some like super dramatic thing that doesn't have anything to do with wrestling, and then we'd watch some WWE or Raw, and then they do that stuff.
Yeah,
it's unbelievable. Like cut out to the parking lot where Vince McMahon's in his limo. It's like they're already out and doing entire. You know, it was hard to satirize. That's where we kind of decided not to even satirize wrestling. Just take it to a whole another place, really. And we learned that backyard wrestling is huge too.
Yeah,
that there's tons of backyard wrestling things, and see, that's kind of out of touch.
I just don't. I never got it. I never got wrestling. I never got, like, because I don't think. I mean, definitely, there's a few people stupid enough to think it's real. But for the most part, I don't even think the people there think it's real. So it's just like, what is the point?
No, people love it. I loved it. I loved it for like when I was in 7th and 8th, 9th grade. I totally loved it. And I kind of thought, I didn't think it was real. I just thought it was athletic, I guess. And I got into the characters. I remember it was like the Road Warriors and Hulk Hogan and. It was like all that stuff. The Ugandan Giant. I remember all that.
Yeah.
I just think, you know, there's a point in your life when it just hits you perfectly. Like, but you know who's a big fan of wrestling? Who told me he's a big fan of wrestling is Rick Rubin.
Still?
He loves wrestling. It's like, he's like, yeah, we were talking about sports, and he's like, no, I'm not really into sports, but I love wrestling. And he does. He loves, like, WWE and stuff. I hope I didn't.
I hope I didn't out him. Yeah. But there are tons of people who like it, and they hire. That's the other thing we found out, that they hire real. I mean, they hire not real, but they hire television writers. A lot of people who work on shows like CSI or ER, like or comedy, you know, sitcom writers. They write television writers to, and they carry arcs through entire seasons and stuff. So it's kind of not that different than what we do. there's a bit of it that's just like putting on a show every week. You know, it's just that's their kind of way they package it is in wrestling instead of animation or whatever. Should we move on?
Yeah, good.
Boy, wrestling sure is fun.
So this episode was inspired by both the that movie The Cove and, of course, the Whale Wars TV show, which, again, you know, just like any time we always see a glimpse of something, and then when we decide to do a show about it, we've got to really sit down and kind of study it and see what to make fun of and everything. And I had already, it was actually my dad that had said to me, you know, have you seen this Whale Wars show? And I'd only see the ads, and he goes, it's just these guys and they don't really do anything. My dad said, you know, have you seen this show? Basically, they really don't seem to do anything. So then I caught it a couple times, and it definitely was like, you know, they claim they have this big rad opening and everything, and it's an hour long, and it's always like, okay, we're gonna do that. They come up with some big plan, and then somehow they fuck it up, where it's like, oh, they're gonna do this big rad thing, but then they break the boat, or then someone hurts themselves or whatever. But
they still build up the whole thing dramatically.
Yeah.
Like, what's gonna happen when we go and like stop these Japanese whalers? Will they attack? Will they do this? It's who knows what's gonna happen. And they interview all the people and they say, are you scared to go on this mission? It's like, I'm pretty freaked out about this. It's just pretty hardcore.
Yeah.
And then all that stuff. And then they go, and then the crane doesn't work, so they can't get the boat in, and so that's all in that episode.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, you can't do that.
Fucking do that. And so it was one of these things where at first we were making fun of it.
Dishonest TV.
We were making fun of it, and then, but what had happened was we'd already done Dead Celebrities, where we were super pissed off at Ghost Hunters, thinking, wow, this is a show where nothing happens, and people play this music and do whatever, and just a show of nothing happening, until we saw Whale Wars, and we're like, wow. This is truly people doing nothing and trying to make an hour worth of television out of it. And
it couldn't even be a good half hour of television, and they stretch it out so much.
Yeah.
But like, if you're shooting a show where you're like, we're going to go stop whales from being killed, when you fuck up and you don't use the crane right?
Yeah.
You get that on film, you cut that out of the show.
Right.
And then you don't put yourself fucking up on film and then make that, and then build that up dramatically, like what's going to happen. That's the part that pissed me off.
No, and then
they would
build it up over the course of it. They would like do an episode, and then it's just like, well, you know what? Tomorrow we're going to go on their ship and ruin their, and we're going to like smash their stuff. And it's like, oh, wow, okay, now you're getting rad. Now you are being pirates. And then you would come back the next week and be like, let's go, and be like, oh, they're gone now. We can't do that. And then they would just start over, like you're supposed to be fine with that.
There's one part where they are going back to port because the engine blew up, probably because somebody screwed up. But so they can't. So here you are. You've done a whole. You're doing a whole television show. You've sold us on like, here, watch the arc of this season. And then it gets to a certain point, and they're basically like, well, one of the engines is screwed up. So now they've got to spend 2 weeks and go all the way back to Melbourne to port to get it fixed. Which is just like, well, just cut that out of the show. That has nothing to do with any whales or anything.
Nothing happened.
Your show's fucked up. Now you got to just wait 3 months and shoot the end. But whatever. So they shoot this, and so on the way back to port, first of all, the crew has a big party because they have nothing to do for 2 weeks, and they all get drunk, and then the captain gets mad at them for no reason, and then there's a storm coming, and they build it up like, oh my God, will the crew survive the perfect storm? And they're turn, 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 turn. And then it cuts to sunshine coming through the clouds. He goes, well, the crew survived the perfect storm.
They did, but they made you sit through a commercial for that, too.
And they build it up.
And it was just the like, perfect there is storm. Not, there wasn't
it
any,
was raining. It was there not even, there was like one shot of it was kind of raining and people, and they made him go up on the deck to like slip around a little bit. It's ridiculous.
But then we finally saw the episode where the captain, that Paul, what's his name, Paul Watson?
Paul Watson,
he said he got shot by the Japanese.
You've
got to see this because it's ridiculous. It's like he's just standing there and suddenly he gets this and the camera's like perfectly poised and he turns to the camera and is like, oh, I've been shot. And they make this big thing. The captain's been shot. And it's like,
You are lying. You're a liar, and you're totally lying. And people are like, and but that's what happens with people like this. Matt and I are just as against whaling and all that as anybody. But, dude, we're way more against people going out and basically saying, well, my cause is so just that I can say people shot me when they didn't.
The Japanese shot me.
That's what he's a liar and he's lying.
Just so shitty.
Piece of shit. And so that's what happened.
I seriously, after watching that show, it made me, like, sympathize with the Japanese whaler. Totally. Somehow it's that badly done of a television show and that lame of a subject that you actually side with the guys who are killing whales.
Yeah.
You actually got, please kill some more whales. Get going.
Fuck that guy.
And it happened because when we first started the show.
I want that guy to lose.
As you can see, we're very heated about this because, like, when we first started the show, you know, like Thursday, Friday, it was just like, you know, oh, and we'll kind of make fun of those people. But we had to sit down and watch this stuff. And Matt and I kept going into each other's offices going, dude, no, watch this one. Watch this. Watch that. And then we saw the one where you get shot. We're like, fuck this guy. And it all became, that's why we.
I didn't even watch
so
any Whale Wars until we started. I never even heard of it because I'd seen The Cove. And then we started talking about the whole Japanese part of it. And it wasn't until somebody's like, oh, there's that other show. We should watch that and see if we can do anything with that. And then I was just fascinated with like how crappy of television it was.
Yeah.
It just lied to you.
Yeah. Wait, let's move on. I'm pissed off.
So here's the episode we're going to get killed for, probably.
This is the one. We thought it might be the Kanye episode for a second, but then that didn't work. So we tried doing a show about Harley riders.
But you know what? It's okay. Because I do hate Harley riders.
It'd be worth it.
I hate Harleys. I just hate... There's so many play... Like, when you just... And I know so many of you can relate to this, but just like... So many times you finally have a nice, relaxing day. You get somewhere and just some asshole with his loud fucking bike that he's probably tweaked to be even louder for God only knows why. I just don't get it.
Yeah, don't get it. Never have. So I thought we'd do this episode where we changed the word fag to mean Harley riders instead of homos.
Yeah.
But I mean, we kind of, you know, when we did some research about the word, it was interesting because fag is a derogatory term for homosexuals, really didn't develop until, according to the internet, according to stuff we looked up, was like early part of the 19th century or 20th century in America. So it's pretty recent. I mean, you know, and before that it was like a derogatory term for women. And, you know, and so there's just that idea that, like, well, sometimes these derogatory hate-filled terms, they kind of switch targets. So it's like a virus. They jump from one group to another. And just the idea of like, well, why don't we redefine that word, you know, and get it off, you know, we've all kind of progressed past, or not we all have, but we should as a society progress past there. Why don't we just put it on somebody else? And we thought Harley riders would be the perfect people.
Yeah.
Because they really are annoying and they deserve the hate that the word has. This also got us a little bit of trouble with GLAAD. GLAAD came out, said we shouldn't have done
GLAAD
this.
GLAAD came out.
Yeah, GLAAD came out, said we shouldn't have done this. It was they were kind of mad because they thought people would use the word more, but right. I don't really think so. I think the show is such a huge the underlying implicit part of the show is that gay people are fine and they don't deserve that word,
right?
And you shouldn't call them that with any hate
unless they ride a Harley.
But it's also like let's. So that's kind of their job is to always come out and say, look, people shouldn't be calling each other fags.
Right.
But there's no way. We thought, why can't we start a movement? What if it really took off and like we got it off of gay people and onto like annoying loud people, or you know, even if it was that general. It's like, why not? Why can't it be redefined?
Seems like that would be really great. Because that's what I mean. When Stan says, you know, someone, you're trying to turn left and some asshole in his BMW comes through and you're like, fag. Like, it totally has nothing to do with you're gay at all. There's nothing in my mind when I scream fag at that guy, there's nothing that is in my mind saying homosexuality anything. It's just you're like a fucking Harley rider, you fucking faggot.
But the difference is that gay people who've been called that get really mad. But the problem that my issue is the same is I've been called fag like 1,000 times, and I'm in my life, probably 10,000 times in my life, probably more than most gay people have, because that was just a term of that was like the term everyone used growing up in school.
But it was always like, but that's
so
the thing.
It's much different for me to be called a fag and a gay, and I won't know what it's like to be a gay person being called a fag. But on the flip side, they don't know what it's like to be me,
right,
being called a fag, where it really is just like you're a dipshit, you know. And maybe originally you can see terms, you can see parts of it where it's used like you're a sissy, that maybe you're kind of.
But that's so 70s or 80s.
It's
like
just
being,
like, yeah. It's
because
not
when we got called fags, when you're someone in our generation and you were a kid and you got called a fag, there was nothing in your mind that went, oh, what did I do that was sissy-like or whatever. You're like, oh, what did I do that was lame?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like,
we should somehow it seems like we could help with this episode. It was our intention, at least, to speed up that process of getting the
word. It was
going to
happen, but then Glad screwed it all up.
And then Glad said we shouldn't put it. So we're pulling this episode. They actually asked us to pull the episode, which is pretty funny. That's all.
That's insane, yeah.
Even Comedy Central was like, we're not fucking pulling the episode, dude. Like, the episode is a pro-gay and pro-not saying this with any hate towards homosexuals. You know, you just got to kind of get over it.
See, that's a fag.
And with that, let's move on.
Yeah.
Really? You do? What? Yeah, think about it, guys.
So this is crazy because we are now literally doing commentary for a show we finished 6 days ago. 5.5 days ago.
We just finished this. So it was on last week.
You know, it was funny because a lot of people thought, oh, we needed to do a big rip on Glenn Beck. But it really is. I mean, there's been Glenn Beck's since the beginning of time on both sides. And that was both Matt and I's thing was, you know, we didn't want to take a position of like, A, that Glenn Beck's anything new, and B, that it's really like dangerous or anything, because neither of us really think that.
Yeah, some of the writers in our room wanted us to do a Glenn Beck show where Cartman becomes Glenn Beck and he starts ripping on Wendy Testaberger, but they wanted, you know, we talked about making a token to make it an Obama thing. And there's like some of the kids form a mob and they want to kill. And it just was like, it just seems so lame. It just seems so like level one. And it seemed like people always think that it's just hilarious. Like, talking about this episode in particular made us realize how crazily Republicans and Democrats have just, they just got up out of their chairs in the dining room and switched chairs in the last year. It's like all of a sudden marching is dangerous and Democrats are making fun of marchers. And Republicans think protesting is the coolest thing in the world, even though 5 years ago they thought
it was
like,
exactly the
it's
reverse.
It's like watching Fox News.
2 years
like,
ago was exactly
it was exactly the reverse. The Democrats were like, dissent is patriotic. Now dissent is loony. You know, it's just funny how everyone kind of switched places. And so but even with all that, and Glenn Beck and people like that aren't new. Glenn Beck is pretty fucking funny.
Yeah,
because he's just so out of his league. He's kind of like at the grown-ups table and shouldn't be at the grown-ups table. Yeah. It's like the kid who comes over to the grown-ups table on Thanksgiving and is like, I read some Ayn Rand and I'm going to start talking. And you're like, shut the fuck up, kid. And it feels like we read a little thing about how Glenn Beck he started out in morning radio and was a morning zoo guy. And it was like, he's perfect at that.
Yeah.
And when you see his interviews with kind of like non-political people, he's like a real lively, entertaining, you know, guy. But it's like it's like 5 years ago he went to college for a year and a half and he learned some words like socialism, fascism. He learned about 6 years of history during World War II.
And he became a Mormon.
And he became
sort
a Mormon.
Of says it all right
and
there.
And he spun it into this massive career. It's pretty amazing. But I guess, you know, for us that would be Cartman. I mean, Cartman has to be that guy, really.
So. And then it was pretty funny because then, of course, just showing how old we're getting and everything, we had a big Casey Kasem joke.
Which to us is way funnier than any of the Glenn Beck shit. Yeah. Like Casey Kasem. Yeah, how dated we are.
So many of the kids watching the show don't even know who Casey Kasem is.
But you know, when you're listening to AM radio driving across the country, America's top 40, right?
Yeah. But it was also because we've only seen the trailers for Avatar. And not taking anything away from James Cameron, because he's obviously a very talented director, but it really did look like Dances with Smurfs to us. It was basically like, Matt was saying that basically, like, you watch the trailer, you know exactly what happens in the movie. Like, there's no,
you can
we're always so protective
moment.
Of like we don't even want to let out, like, oh, this is what happens in the show, because we don't want to, like, we want things to be a surprise. But it's just like, that trailer is just like, this happened, this, you've seen this, you've seen that, you've seen this, it all happened, but now it's in 3D and everyone's
You don't know every single detail, but you basically know the big moments, yeah. And you know the big pivot points. Like, I've kind of seen that movie before, yeah. But with different kinds
of... It's basically Dances with Wolves.
It's basically he's going native.
But like, Smurf.
Okay, he went native and he got use of his, he got use of his legs, he got all stoked, he fell in love with her, she found out, you betrayed me,
yeah.
I'm going to get a ragtag bunch, you have to believe us this time, you know all that shit.
Yeah.
But with really, but not Smurfs. 8 or 10 foot tall sexy Smurfs.
Yeah. Which is just the 2009 version of Smurfs. Which, what, that movie comes out, what, in like 2 weeks or something?
Yeah, it comes out December 18th.
I'll bet it's pretty sweet.
I'm definitely seeing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll definitely be fun. And I like Smurfs, so yeah. I'm going to have to go see it. Is that good?
Yeah, I think that's good.
Moving on.
Good morning, South Park Elementary. These are the morning announcements.
So this is actually unprecedented in...
I think in movie history.
Probably, yeah. Probably in commentary history. We're actually doing commentary for a show that's not done. As we're sitting here doing this, it's Monday night. The show airs on Wednesday. And this show, more than any, actually this entire season probably, is way under-animated because it all takes place in a water park. So we had to draw everything from scratch. And we just came up with the idea Thursday. So... Everything had to be so. Basically, there's nothing for us to see on the screen. And the only reason we're in here doing commentary right now is because we're so behind in animation that I'm actually okay on the writing side. So we've got everything figured out script-wise. Well, there's big moments we don't have figured out, but for a Monday, I mean, we're pretty good actually. But we're in here because animation is out there right now, 50 yards away from us, just. Flipping out and trying to get through all the shots they've got to do.
Yeah, it's
pretty funny
that we gave them.
Yeah,
we said here, but
it was another water park idea. Was another idea we just sort of had for a long time, just because it's such a kid thing. There's a place in Denver called Waterworld that we would always go to.
Yeah, I remember Waterworld. Went there. That was definitely like a summer pilgrimage.
Yeah,
you definitely had to go. A lot of good memories there, but also a lot of like sunburns and stuff too. But we just had. I think we had a. We talked about. A water park episode with Jimmy and a surfing movie.
But it always
Jimmy
involved there. Pee-pee.
It was always called Pee-pee's Water World, and we always had the joke of...
It used to be Pee-pee's Urine World.
Yeah, but then it was like Urine Town, which is that thing.
Yeah. Pee-pee's Urine world, that's what it was.
Which is that joke that pee-pee, it's just pee.
Yeah.
Because you know, when you go to a water park, it pretty much is pee anyway. And that they didn't even have bathrooms. Or when you go into the stalls, there's cobwebs, which right. We still might do in this show, but maybe not. That joke.
I had him draw it. It's drawn. So we don't know. As we're sitting here, we don't know.
If it
could end up
in
the show, or it might not.
Then that's then. If it's not, then...
We also don't know right now. The only things we don't know right now is how we're going to get into that disaster. So right now, they just say, Pee-Pee, you got to close it down or whatever. And then right now, it just cuts to a bunch of disaster. And we know that we need like that final kid peeing and then some kind of thing.
Right.
But as we're sitting here, we have no idea.
And the meter's going crazy and the alarms or whatever it is that starts it or the electricity or...
And so it's Monday, so I just today handed off the scene. I wrote and handed off the scenes that are Cartman's whole thing, sitting there imagining what the future's going to be like with all the minorities. And also all the stuff about Kyle having to drink urine, that was all just thought of this morning
Monday.
And written today.
And like there's the last minute, 1 minute or minute and a half of the show isn't even written.
The last scene of the show, we have no idea.
That's what I'm saying, last minute and a half scene.
We want some, we're thinking,
we know basically
it could end up this way. We're thinking something to do with the fact that Kyle had to drink the pee, and then he says the only thing grosser than drinking pee is bananas, and then they're basically like, you have to eat this banana now or we're going to kill you.
I think it's funny.
I think that's funny. It's probably somehow what we'll end up doing, but we don't know how we're going to tie up Cartman's story.
Well, Cartman's story, we're talking about tying up with the storm thing.
With the Terminator.
The end of Terminator thing. That basically, Cartman now has seen, the point of his story is he's seen a future where
He knows it's coming.
He's the only white person in a world full of minorities. Which is funny.
And he knows that in 2012 we're all dead.
So he just sees the storm coming like she does at the end of Terminator. So someone can say that line in Spanish.
I don't know what to say. But we're right now dangerously close to getting like long, which sucks because then you start getting long and then you want to add lines, but then you start getting 25 minutes long and it just becomes horrible. So it's interesting. We'll see what happens. But at least now we're done with doing commentary. So
we're not done with the show, but we're done with the commentary for the show.
So now we're going to leave this and go walk over and look at a bunch of shots and then be here for a while and then be up all night tomorrow night trying to finish the show. So hopefully you like it. I don't know. You probably have, you'll know it better than me.
Thank you. Water park, my water park.
Oh boy, it's commentary time.
Oh.
This is Trey Parker.
Matt Stone, we're excited to be back here doing mini commentaries for season 14.
And as of usual, we just finished season 14 2 days ago, so we just finished doing the episode. What was it called?
Yeah, we just finished called
Cream Free.
We just finished one called Cream Free.
So now we're back talking about the first show of that season, which was this Sexual Healing, which we did back in March
17th. Here it is,
so it's
right
been
here.
Like,
March 17th.
So it's we did this quite a while ago.
Yeah, I mean, it was really great because we were. I think we had some other ideas for the season before it started, but then
Tiger Woods blessed us with it.
And it was also all that anybody could talk about over the like the holidays or over. That was it. It was just like, oh, because it was Thanksgiving night he did it, right? So this is March, and it still was like.
It still was the big news.
Because then all the text messages had come out and stuff, and then it was like, oh, it wasn't just that night. It was like, he's a sex addict.
But the big thing was, we're like, well, we're an animated show. We could sort of recreate what probably happened that night. And so that was that first scene that you just saw was sort of our version of. Of, all right, let's put everything together that we've heard, and we assume it happened basically exactly like this. This is probably what really went down.
Looks realistic.
Because it was just that, as with everyone, the funniest part was that, you know, it was like, okay, she swung a golf club at a car and broke a window, had found out he cheated, but she was just trying to save his life. It's like, okay.
Right. But she just found out he was cheating.
Yeah.
So she decided to help him.
And then it was later that we kind of had the idea of we'll do that recreation, but then we'll make it the video game. Because then, just as I wrote, then like Tiger Woods, whatever that version, that video game, Tiger Woods 3 or whatever, was coming out that week too. So it was just pretty cool. And then we always, and then as soon as the Tiger Woods thing happened, we had this idea of like treating it like all the dudes being like, what? Being incredulous to the whole idea that.
And all the men basically, like, because it was that thing where, when you're at a, a holiday party or whenever, Tiger Woods became that thing that just became kind of strange for men and women to talk about a little bit. I think because there was a little language barrier between, like, so men had to act ultra, like, I don't know why he would do that.
Right.
You know? And it's kind of like the whole Chris Rock joke about, like, you're only as true as, you're only as faithful as opportunity allows, or there's that whole Chris Rock thing. You know, that every guy, and basically every girl knows in the world, too, but... The discussion that took place in the press about sexual addiction and stuff seemed to just miss the entire, this gap that, everyone has to acknowledge that, everyone knows what the fuck was going on with that.
But that's why, a bunch of dudes had to be, whenever it came up, and he'd be like, what do you mean? Oh, my God, he's married. He's super successful and the biggest athlete in the world, but he's married. How would he ever be with another woman?
And newspaper articles and stuff written by men.
Yeah.
And you could tell they're like, is sexual addiction a problem in our country? And it's like, you fucking, look at you, dude.
The first person you showed that to was your wife.
Yeah, you showed that to your wife.
Look, honey, look what I think. These guys have a problem. They have a problem because I can't relate to it at all.
I don't know why someone would do that.
So that was obviously the gist of it. that fist bump thing.
God,
everyone's basically acting for the one woman in the room.
No, that was that show.
Yeah.
Don't they throw Kyle in there? Is it Kyle
they throw
or Butters?
Kyle and Butters, I think.
Kyle and Butters.
I can't remember.
This is like, how long ago is this?
This is like, what, 8 months ago?
8 months ago, can't even remember. What happens?
We've been working on like a Broadway show since then and stuff, so we write this stuff and then we forget all about it.
Yeah.
So let's go to the next one and see what we did.
Let's see what else we forgot.
Okay, kids, let's take our seats.
So this is the tale of Scrody McBoogerballs, which basically the whole idea came out of, I remember from when I was it was more junior high and high school, but I had a friend of mine, we would always try to write the most disgusting thing we ever could, and we'd sort of switch off every other sentence. We'd sort of fill in the next sentence, fill in, and try to gross each other out, and then, of course, a teacher or a parent would end up finding it, and then we'd deny we ever did it. But it sort of came from that, and then the idea, there was an old Monty Python sketch. I don't remember the name of the sketch, but it's basically
the funniest joke in the world. Yeah, funniest joke in the world.
And so... I'm sure it's on YouTube. You check it out. But like, it's like basically, they, someone writes a joke and then sits there, and as soon as he writes the joke, he starts laughing and then he has a heart attack and dies. So they're like, and then the military starts using it because it's the funniest joke in the world. They start using that joke and no one can hear it and not, laugh so hard that they die. And then in other languages, there's a great part with Hitler in it,
mm-hmm.
where Hitler's trying to tell a joke and it's not as good. So it was really cool because we were such Python fans, and it was like this was the same kind of idea that like in a different way that was just like the most disgusting thing ever, and people can't help but vomit, but then this added extra thing where it's like it's actually really good.
Yeah.
And you know, it's sort of like when we had that idea of like no one can deny how, and just the idea that you're doing this comedy about centered around this whole thing that you never show, you know, you never hear more than one sentence of the actual book and everything. And so
it's like Pulp Fiction with the there's a name for that. What's it called? Like Pulp Fiction, what's in the suitcase, and Repo Man, what's in the trunk. It's like you never reveal
what is this thing? What is this thing that can make people vomit.
And it was also that idea of a band books, and our kids, especially, you know, these boys would be like, first of all, band books are rad. I want to know what's in them. And when I find out what's in them, like, we could do a better job at, like, we could write a fucking grosser book than that, not understanding that there's any literary value to any band books. Which is kind of the way I think I thought about band books when I was, like, you wanted, you know, obviously to read them first. Yeah. There's our kill line, John Lennon, Catcher in the Rye joke.
And then, of course,
that was hot in the news at that time too.
None of that really mattered. Everyone just liked this show because people threw up a lot. So,
and then also the what's his face, the poop that took a pee.
Oh yeah, I studied Morgan Freeman's voice.
We did a lot of Morgan. It was really about getting that to that Morgan Freeman joke that we wanted to do.
Yeah, just Morgan Freeman reading. It's like whenever you want something to be validated, you get Morgan Freeman to read it, and it suddenly makes sense.
That's what he is, and that's what we figured out in movies. He's like the guy that comes and just like, here's this ridiculous fucking concept. Have Morgan Freeman explain it to you, and you'll believe it.
Yeah.
You know.
If Morgan Freeman explains it to Angelina Jolie, then it makes sense. And we were saying that every time he does that, he gets a new freckle.
Yeah. That's right. Every time Morgan Freeman explains an impossible concept in a movie, he gets another freckle.
Well, let's move on to the next one, because it's one of my favorites.
This is our medicinal marijuana show. That I think came about because I think I'd gone back to Colorado, or you had gone back to Colorado, and they had Colorado is kind of like California now, where there's medicinal pot stores. But Colorado is actually way beyond California. There's pot stores everywhere in Colorado now. It's pretty rad, actually. It's like the kind of outdid California. And I think this episode, I think we started talking about this, and then how certain kind of like. How fatty food now is like the new, like, okay, we've got to ban that. You know, it's like how certain substances and shit become like okay in society, and then other ones become not okay, and how this fatty food and pot. And then when we were in the writers' meeting, it's like somehow KFC came up, and we were talking about how this idea of a pot store opening up at a KFC. I think you talked about it. I think Trey said something about it. And I was like, I've seen that before on somewhere online, and there's a pot store in L.A.,
in Venice, right?
In Palms, I think, that was an old KFC that somebody turned into a pot store. And it basically looked just like this. Like, so it was funny that we joked our way to a place where that basically actually existed. Yeah.
But that was a funny thing about Colorado, too, because you were saying how, like, in Steamboat Springs, there was a medicinal marijuana store, and there's, like, two registered people that can get medicinal. It's like, okay, obviously they're not just catering to those two people.
Right. No, I mean, I'm a total, you know, I think that, you know, it's... I'm a total believer that basically if pot can help people who are sick, and I know people who've been sick with AIDS or cancer, that weed has really helped them eat. And I mean, I'm a big believer in all that, but obviously everyone knows it's kind of a sham too, you know, that like everyone who's going to medicinal marijuana doesn't have cancer and they're going for their quote back pain or something.
No.
So, you know, obviously that's the story is Randy, instead of pretending he has back pain, which is really all you need to do is just say my back hurts or my knee hurts or some shit. And he goes and gives himself testicular cancer.
Right.
So,
but that it was sort of that joke too of like so many of the people that fight so hard for marijuana should be legal are some of the same people that are saying, you know, get rid of KFC, get rid of Taco Bell, get rid of this stuff's bad for you. You know, it's just like, and what doesn't matter what the truth is, like they're just trying to oppress a different group of people. So it's like
that's just something they don't like.
Yeah. So,
but for some people, you know, they get just as high off fried chicken as other people do off weed. You know.
And then once we had the idea that Randy should get testicular cancer and have giant balls, then we're like, oh, this is gold.
Yeah, and then gold we came mine. Up with, what's that song? What's the song from? It's from those little bouncer things, or what's that, the song that plays?
Oh, the Hippity Hop?
Is it from the Hippity Hop?
Well, that's what we were talked about being was the hip, but then, no, the song we got was just some random.
No, it was off a weird 70s commercial, remember?
Oh, right.
I can't remember what it was, though.
No, I can't remember either.
Boy, we should know for commentary, but we don't.
We should watch these before commentary on them.
Instead of going, hey, this is really cool. I wish I could tell you about it, but I can't. Sorry about that. So in the end, they make medicinal fried chicken.
And everyone's happy.
And everyone's happy. So, but really, honestly, like, if you're a stoner, Colorado is the place to be. It's pretty rad. And hopefully they'll vote to legalize it pretty soon. So it'll be like...
Yeah, they might be California to it, right?
I think, yeah, they could be. California just voted it down, like, right, a bunch
so
of
that's
fucking...
That's going
to be a while. God, don't get me started on California liberals voting down fucking Prop 19. God damn it. Finally,
and moving on.
Finally, someone opened the jail door and you don't walk out.
And moving on.
Finally, you're free. Let's move on before I get into that.
What? I've got more friends than Kyle. I've got more friends than Kyle.
So this was our big Facebook episode, which we just finally had to do because I resisted Facebook for a long time, and then I finally just decided it was like an easy way. I was seeing if I could get in touch with some friends from high school. And so I sort of reluctantly signed up, you know, just said, okay, well, I guess I'll just get a little page. And then I definitely got sucked in for about a week. At first I was like, oh, wow, that, you know, I was suddenly getting in touch with a lot of people who I had not heard from since, you know, junior high or high school. And I thought that was really cool. And then those same people just kept coming back and wanted to know if I wanted to play chess online and what I had eaten the night before. And very, very quickly I started going, this is not cool. This sucks. And so at first it was kind of, but it was sort of just this feeling like, wow, I'm really getting sucked into it. Because then suddenly people were like being angry, saying, hey, I posted something on your wall and you didn't read it. And I was like, well, I'm only going to look at it once a couple weeks or something. But then people started getting offended that I wasn't responding to their stuff on Facebook. And so I literally just had this feeling like I was getting sucked into something I did, and it was like so much bigger than me that I couldn't help but get sucked into it. And so we just decided to make that stand and have him sort of literally get sucked into it and use the whole idea of what would it be inside Facebook, and we decided it would be Tron.
Right, because you know, Tron was such a sweet movie growing up. And
the old Tron, as of this recording, we haven't seen the new Tron.
No, it comes out in December. I'm gonna go on record and I think it looks pretty sweet, relatively cool, and I'm really psyched to see it. Now, I'll update you next commentary on if that panned out, if it was any good. But it looks pretty cool.
I'm just worried they could go kind of Michael Bay with it and like Transformers with it, where you're just kind of like, oh no, you know, like.
Yeah, but
they just get into people's feelings and stuff.
Oh, I think it is going to be a little bit like that. I think, but I think there'll be some good big set pieces and stuff. Yeah. And Daft Punk does the soundtrack. That's pretty cool. Like, they made a couple of cool choices. And the fact that What's His Ass is in it, Jeff Bridges.
Yeah, that's cool.
That's pretty cool. So. Overall, cool. This little kid, Kip Drordy. Drordy, I think we made it.
Yeah.
I love these scenes with him, these scenes where he just runs in and checks to see if anybody sent a message. I mean, they're sadly probably close to truth for a lot of people. And I mean, I'm not going to talk about it. I mean, I've done that too with an email you're waiting for somebody to, you know, how much like one text message or you're waiting on one person to send you something. But I love those scenes. They have kind of a... I don't want to say Pixar, like they're as good as Pixar, but they have a great, like they're just without having any dialogue.
No, it's always
packed
nice
with emotion.
When you can do a scene with no dialogue and it's good, like,
and it's that emotionally kind of like you're.
That's why Pixar is so good at what they do, because they can do that all the time.
Yeah, like every scene in every movie, almost every movie, and make it work. But that little kid turned out to be much more of an emotional kind of story than we even intended. And now he has a little Facebook page that I think the South Park Studios guys administer, and I think he has like 400,000 friends. Which is pretty cool. They still do updates that are like, ate some pizza today.
Yeah.
Is anything else in this episode?
It's really all very Facebook heavy. We had a scene. We used to have more of Cartman doing the whole what's his name thing. You know, the thing he does, the money guy on CNN.
Jim Cramer.
Yeah, we had more of those. And actually, it's probably on this DVD of like the deleted scenes, because there was.
Yeah, because it was like treating friends like stocks.
Yeah,
and taking my stock's up today. I've got two more friends. Oh no, I lost some friends today. I'm down. You know.
Because originally the story was really going a lot more that direction, but then we just liked the stand stuff so much, and then we didn't even know about this whole farm thing that you the Farmville. But they were just the same thing. Like, people, I would constantly be walking by animators here at South Park, and they'd have these little farms up on their dad. I'm like, what is that? And they're like, oh, it's Facebook. And so we're like, okay, we're putting that in the show. You know, people, because I was
asking. It used to be
people,
World of Warcraft, and now it's Farmville on their screens.
You know, and so we were asking the animators and stuff, like, okay, well, so then people can come and visit your farms? Like, yeah. And it's like, well, so then what's the goal? And you're like, well, nothing. You just try to have a nice farm. It's like, so you can make your farm way cooler than everyone else. It's like, no, not really. You know, it's like all this stuff. Just like, grown people are doing this during the day during South Park.
I think that's all from this episode.
I think that's probably all we know.
We just spit out everything we can think of, and then that's it. Yeah. Next, please.
How?
Our factory works.
So this was our 200th episode, which got some attention.
It should have been such a time for celebration.
Yeah, it wasn't even. The thing was, we didn't even meet. It was just like, oh, for show 200, let's just give the real fans a, you know, kind of a taste of, you know, basically like the whole thing was like, let's do a clip show, but not do a clip show. Like, let's do in a clip show where they would normally sit there and go, oh, here's our best moments. Here, look at this again. But clip shows today are so stupid for anyone to do because anyone can go watch DVDs or whatever. So like, let's do a clip show, but let's take sort of the biggest, most famous moments in South Park and let's revisit them and then make them all into its own plot. And it was actually kind of a fun one to write because
it was like by design. It was like, it's our 200th episode. We're going to do the most self-indulgent kind of episode there is. It's going to be the episode is about the show,
right?
About the its biggest controversies, its biggest kind of moments. So it's like, it's not, it's by design kind of up our own ass and about our, you know, about the show.
And so it was just one of many things. They were like, oh, well, we can't do a big show about our biggest controversial things without doing one with the prophet of the Muslim faith. So we'll put that in there too. And it really wasn't even, we honestly, it was just one of many things. We thought, obviously we spent way more time with the Barbara Streisand monster than we did with that. That was just, but, since then, you know, it just became this big thing, and obviously we're still upset, pissed off about it all. But I mean, I guess we can just wait till the next one because it was a two-parter. So, that's sort of the setup of it all, and then we can go to because it was the second part where basically all the shit hit the fan while we were making part two, which again we were just trying to. What we thought was far more important and far more interesting was that we were finally going to answer who Eric. We were bringing back the biggest. The way bigger than the prophet of Muslim faith was, you know, Eric Cartman actually did have a father, and this, and we're going to reveal it. And we thought that that was just so huge that we didn't really think anything else would happen. But we'll just go to the next one.
Yeah, well, I say.
So obviously, this is a great opening to a show. I love this opening, and I love this song. And I love how just like what
it just starts with his fist.
And it just starts with the craziest, like, what the fuck? Yeah. Like, where did this come from?
Yeah, why are we starting here? But this is actually really hard because we're supposed to be sitting here doing commentary on something we're really not supposed to talk about at all. Obviously, we got the way we intended this to air never got aired. It got changed. We didn't change it. And it was kind of hard for us because whereas sort of the first one where we did the Prophet of the Muslim Faith with Family Guy, we purposely kind of made it the joke that we couldn't show him. And now here... It went even, suddenly between the week of making the first one and this one coming out, so much shit hit the fan and that basically every, you know, we couldn't even, our hands were completely tied. And so we're like, well, we're just going to deliver it this way, the way we think it should be, and then you'll have to do what you have to do to it. And so it got sort of butchered on air. And so, and it's butchered here too. They, you know, we still can't show it the way we made it, including the final speech, which wasn't a joke on, people thought it was a joke that that's all beeped, but actually... It's not. It had a point. It had, we thought, a good point. But the thing, and really, besides that, which everyone already knows, and we already said in the statement, we don't really know anything we can say about this episode because it'll probably just get sort of cut out or beeped over somehow. I mean, I think probably the one, probably the thing we could talk about that they wouldn't beep out is that, is just the fact that the...
Really in there. It could be a trick. It's no trick, dude. My friend and I went to the Super Best Friends and brought him here. Then have him step out of the bear costume. You have until the count of 10. One.
Don't do it, Randy. If is seen, we could get bombed.
Two.
Idiot. If he isn't seen, we're about to definitely get bombed.
Three.
All right, stop. We'll do what you say. I'm sorry, but will you please step out of the bear costume?
Okay, so, see? That isn't that's Santa Claus.
sorry, boys. I tried.
Ah, crap.
Boys, you got Santa to be when?
When you all said you were gonna hand over to Tom Cruise. We promised Jesus that would stay safely in the U-Haul.
I'm sorry, Cal. I really thought my idea would work for you.
If we were gonna have someone in a bear costume, why would we actually have it be you idiot?
So where is he?
Meanwhile, at the Hall of the Super Best Friends.
I mean, that was basically it. So
that was it.
All right,
I guess that's enough for that.
Okay,
one. Let's move on. That's cool to know.
This program contains subject matter. This was our first episode after the whole 200 and 201 thing.
Yeah. And we were actually thinking about not doing anymore.
We were just so tired and spent, I remember.
It was such a stressful week, but we decided, we can do it.
Yeah.
One more show.
And I think, I can't remember one other time we were really, really tired and we went to a Jimmy show. It was when the Jimmy Erection show. Yeah, I don't remember where it was in production, but there was something about let's forget about, let's just do something weird,
no point,
and
no,
different. And seventh, kind of last shows of runs, we always kind of go, let's just even break our own rules.
That's
a little
why they're
bit.
So good usually.
Yeah, that's why they're kind of good, because we just kind of give up. We just kind of get outside of our own.
But it was interesting.
Box.
Actually, we had this stuff. So we're kind of thinking about what we can do. We're all out of ideas. And it was just such a stressful 2 weeks. And we were just so pissed and burnt and everything. But we came across some of this footage. And actually, it was from the whole Oprah Winfrey Minge show.
Brilliant, that show. Yeah. Everyone's favorite.
But it's so funny because we came across these scenes that we had cut out of that, which is basically all of this stuff. Because in that show originally, Tally did go to intervention, and he had an intervention and he did all this stuff. And we were parodying the show Intervention, which I watched all the time because I love watching people who are more fucked up than me. And but we watched these scenes. We're like, this is pretty funny. And it had been a while since the Oprah's. We're like, maybe we could make, take these scenes and make it into its own show. We just didn't think it was quite enough to do an entire Tally episode of Tally. So we were like, let's combine it with something. And then we decided to put it with the Jimmy stuff. And then the way they worked together was pretty cool. And so it ended up being pretty cool.
I think it ended up being, it's such a weird episode. But, Jimmy gives us that great, he's just such a great character between all of his weird interests and his crazy optimism.
When it also happened, because we had done a Jimmy show
I think once we came up with Tardy Caca, we're like, okay, this is the kind, this is what we're doing.
This is what you do after you've insulted a lot of people politically. What's funny is that we had done this whole Jimmy show where he goes on steroids and we did the Special Olympics. And there's this one little scene in that show where this sort of, I think we can name him Sean, this one kid is like selling Jimmy steroids,
right?
And he was just like, hey, Jay, how you want steroids? And for some reason, that character always made us laugh so hard. We're like, we got to bring that kid back. And we're like, what if that kid hates Jimmy the same way Jimmy hated Timmy, but that he's totally aware? And then we started talking about the whole old Warner Brothers cartoons where there were the two gangsters.
Yeah.
One was always really short.
Say, boss.
Yeah, and then the really tall one that was like, nah, what you doing, boy? And then the little one that was more like, shut up, shutting up, and all that stuff. So we're like, oh, we got to take, do that, but with handicapped kids. So, which is pretty wrong, but.
I just remember, I like the Colorado, was it the Colorado Mountain Shark?
Just all this shit.
So
that doesn't,
stupid.
It's so funny that by episode
this is the
seven,
most number of ingredients in a dish that, that you, this is like,
who cares?
This is like Southwestern Asian African fusion.
We sort
dish.
Of turn off our snobby writer machines on the last episodes of seasons, and that's why they're
and
kind
they,
of
they get better, yeah. Here's a bunch of other
Warner
Brothers.
Yeah, and then we were like, well, let's do other Warner Brother characters.
As handicapped kids.
Yeah.
That's really funny right there. We could have done a whole show with all these little kids.
I just want to do it again. I wanted actually, so this was the last show of that little part of this run. And then when we came back, instead of starting what we started with, which was the NASCAR show, I want to just start the new show of the new season, and it just pans over, and there those guys are, and it's like, okay, here's how we're going to get rid of Jimmy. It's just like, still just keep going. They're still trying to get rid of him. All right, well, let's move on to the second part of the season. So this was the start of the fall run, fall part of this back half of the season, where we'd been talking a while about doing a NASCAR show, just because NASCAR is so huge and we have some crossover and fans.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is, we just didn't really know much about it. We'd never been to one, obviously, and we hadn't
really watched it on television, so we kind of had to, and we still don't. We,
yeah, I've never really, I've watched a little bit of NASCAR, but it's kind of like, you know, it is that thing where it's kind of hard to get into. Like, it's hard to see, like, what is the allure of this, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I get that it's not, I don't know those people that doesn't, I mean, I think it's a really, it's like a hell of a sport to have to, like, go do. Like, I think they're pretty amazing athletes, the drivers and stuff. But it is like you are driving, all the tracks are exactly the same, and you are driving around in a big circle for 500 miles. It's a thing.
For a long time. That was the part that surprised me, was how long they are.
Yeah, there's a lot to make fun of there. Yeah. And so we just started, like, kind of this great, this is a great scene. I love this scene where Cartman is just like, I'm not porn stupid enough. And they're like, yes, you are. And he's like, quit, you know, trying to make me feel better. But just, I don't even know what this show's saying, really. We just thought it was funny that, like, Cartman is like, I'm not porn stupid enough. And it's like, is he fucking around? Is he really want to be a NASCAR driver?
One is because whenever you have Cartman do something, it's like, you don't know what we're trying to say. Like, are we saying that you need to be porn stupid? Are we ripping on it? Or are we not ripping on it?
And we,
like,
don't even know.
We don't know. I mean, we really don't know it well enough to rip on it either, or not.
But that's the rip on NASCAR, is that basically their fans are poor and stupid, which it doesn't really, I don't think that's true, but it's like Cartman thinking that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Somehow it kind of makes sense.
Yeah.
And the this being the first show of the run, our animators had a little extra time to model the cars in 3D and make that race footage, which I think looks awesome. So, like, this show has really cool production values, the race and stuff.
Yeah. And then we actually ended up having one of our PAs go out and get a bunch of Vagisil, which sat in the writer's room, because we had to know exactly. We didn't, you know, it just like NASCAR, we knew almost as little about Vagisil as we did about NASCAR. We knew a little more about Vagisil, but
yeah.
We didn't know, you know, was it an ointment or a spray or a, you know, what was it? And so the PA, poor PA, had to go out to Walgreens and buy a bunch of Vagisil in every different form.
Every different kind of form. And there's a lot of forms.
And there's still actually a bunch of Vagisil in the writer's room, if anyone needs any.
You know what else is in this video, and we kind of had to, like, fit it in, is the dip vids, which, if you're not familiar with dip vids, you need to go to your computer right now
and
type in dip vid. It's one of the more kind of crazy...
Yeah, actually, the dip vid part of this used to be longer, but then the show became about...
We talked about doing a whole show about dip vids.
Yeah.
Just, dip vids are just so weird and crazy.
Yeah.
And kind of awesome, though. So if you don't know what a dip vid is, go to your computer and type it in and check out how many hundreds of dip vids there are. Just,
we were
going to
do that whole storyline where Cartman was basically dipping Vagisil, and then Vagisil started making flavored Vagisil because all the kids were dipping it, and then Obama banned flavored Vagisil, and so that Cartman could do that same dip vid.
Because if you don't get the reference, which probably no one does because it's a weird, obscure dip vid, is there's a dip vid where a guy bitches about, they banned, like, flavored tobacco products. And he says almost exactly like a bunch, like, the stuff Cartman says parodies what he says. Yeah. But there's a part where he says, Obama's fucking gay for doing that.
Yeah.
It's so funny.
Fucking gay as hell. One of my favorite, there's always stuff when, you know, when whatever little blogs or blurbs write about it. There was some, like, from a legitimate play, it was like this thing when, after the show aired, it's like, South Park calls Obama gay. And I'm like, what? Like that was what they took away from, was that we called the president a homosexual. And it's like, gay as hell does not mean homosexual.
Right. And certainly within that context of where it's just like being a big stupid joke on within a character doing it. But but I think if they shouldn't ban flavored Vagisil.
No.
All right, let's move on.
So this was our big Jersey show, which of course a lot of people thought was because of the Jersey Shore phenomenon, which of course it kind of was, but it was really way more because of my infatuation with Housewives of New Jersey, which I've seen every episode of at least twice. And so it was just, you know, the fact that there was Housewives of Jersey and then Jerseylicious and then the Jersey Shore, it was just like, it seemed like suddenly any reality show with the Jersey word in it was coming out. So we're trying to do not just a take on Jersey Shore, but on the Jersey phenomenon as a whole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and how there just seems to have taken over television. And I had never seen Housewives of Jersey Shore, so when we started in this episode, I watched it.
Yeah. And this woman here at the table is obviously, she's a version of Teresa from Housewives of New Jersey. And by the way, Teresa, I think, really does start most of the fights with Danielle. I mean, obviously Danielle's got super big problems, but I really, you know, when you look back, and Teresa's always talking about what a great person she is and how
she doesn't start. Teresa always starts the fight, always looking for a fight, always looking to cause problems. And of course, since Danielle is completely fucked in the head, it's always going to... Well, anyway, we don't need to really talk about
this. This episode really took off for me when we figured out Muff Cabbage.
Yeah,
Muff Cabbage. And it was like just that joke of like Muff Garbage, Muff Cabbage.
We were just trying to get Muff Cabbage to catch on as a phrase. And now it's actually pretty sweet. You can type on the internet too. Now you can type Muff Cabbage and you'll see people just screaming the word Muff Cabbage. I don't know. It's kind of like they took our jobs. It kind of Muff Cabbage is the new took our job.
Muff Cabbage.
But,
I don't know what
and
else.
Then we had we just had the whole idea of making Snooki into this sort of thing.
I watched, because when we started, I had never seen Jersey Shore either until we started doing this episode. So I watched some Jersey Shores, and I actually really liked it. That first season is
I watched all of season one of Jersey Shore, and I like it's. That's the thing; it's well produced.
It's a really good show.
That's why it's a very watchable show. It has nothing to do with them because you could fit in tons of different people into that and be funny. But it's just well done.
Yeah, it's something compelling about those. I don't know if it's those people in particular or something, but.
But it was part of that when we saw that now season two was going to be Jersey Shore, Miami. It's like, well, it's not Jersey Shore. Yeah. So it's like, that's why it's like, okay, well, Jersey Shore, Colorado. And it was just sort of the idea that the Jersey Shore is now sort of everywhere in the U.S. And it was sort of one of those shows. It took a lot of different routes, and we tried a lot of different things. And then we, you know, finally went the whole Teen Wolf route with Kyle.
That's right, the Teen Wolf thing, yeah.
And just once we had the idea that Carmen learned he was from Jersey, it was the three J's.
Ginger Jew in Jersey.
Yeah. So, who
wants dessert? Yeah,
that's about it.
That's all of our Jersey stuff.
All right. So this episode in Sheepshin was really just started out as our hoarding episode because we had a... It was sort of the same thing as the Jersey thing where it's just like there's two or three different shows on different channels about hoarding all of a sudden.
Mm-hmm.
Hoarders and... So much more frustrating to me than like Intervention. Intervention I can actually watch and enjoy, but Hoarders, you're always just sitting there going, clean that shit up, you know, and there are always people coming and very delicately being like, can I throw this away? And they're like, no, not that. And they're like, okay, you know, and it's just like, throw it away. Tell them to fuck off and throw it away. But so it really was just at first, definitely by Thursday or Friday, the first few days of working on this one, we just thought it was going to be a hoarding thing. We're like, well, let's make it hoarding, but in your locker. And then he can go to the counselor and find out. We'll find out that Mackie was a hoarder, and then we'll, you know, sort of take it from there.
Right. And then we decided to combine it with Inception.
Yeah. Well, I think the same day that we decided, oh, let's have them... They're going to learn why they're hoarders, you know, right. So we'll take them back, we'll hypnotize, or we'll put them into their dreams. And that's when some people in the room start saying, oh, it's like Inception, which I hadn't seen. And so...
Right, we should explain, we had a little dust up on this episode because we basically ripped off these guys from College Humor, but we didn't mean to. And that sounds really what a fucking lame excuse. But what happened is that I had seen Inception, and I think most people in the writer's room had seen it, but Trey hadn't seen it. And so when we were looking at stuff online, and we started looking at different parodies.
Because we couldn't get a copy of the movie. The movie hadn't come out on it.
Couldn't get a copy of the movie. And sometimes we can get like a screener or something like this. And we found a BitTorrent, but it was almost unwatchable. And it's like, you don't even want to watch it on your little computer. So we just watched parodies. And I remember there's this one, we watched this one. It was the one from College Humor that's so well done. And I remember I said to Trey, like, that's it. That's the movie. That's what it is. I know it seems unbelievable, but it's that fucking stupid.
Yeah.
And that was because Inception, the dialogue in Inception, what the guys did on their College Humor thing is like they aped it so well that there were literally parts that I didn't remember if that was like actually in the movie or that. But in saying, Trey, that's the movie, I think Trey then went and
we took the line. There's a part where the guy says, my wife's dreams manifest themselves as train or something like that. And I was like, really? Like, that's in the fucking, that's what it is, you know? And so we just wrote it that way.
But. Yeah, we thought there was a lines of movie. And then, you know, a part of it is not doing any fucking QC on it. And if we would have taken 10 seconds and literally really thought about it.
Or watch the movie.
I mean, there's so many things that, like, so many places along the way where we fucked up and didn't kind of do our homework. And a lot, you know, we do this show so fast, a lot of times kind of first drafts go on the air. And, you know, we hope they're like really good first drafts or at least have the energy and like punk rock, like,
our whole way we excuse it to ourselves as well. At least it's fresh, you know, and it's like, you know, like Saturday Night Live is like not the funniest all the time, but you know it's live and you know they did it that week and that's part of the energy. We've convinced ourselves that that's part of South Park, even when it's like, you know, maybe not the best thing. And this was absolutely one where it just slipped through the, it slipped through the production process. I wasn't paying attention to what it was. Trey had never seen the movie and like assumed those were lines in the movie, and it's just a huge fuck up. And that's just what it is.
But then luckily you kind of knew one of the guys.
I know a guy who run, who works at College Humor, and he, you know, let me know basically the second after these guys wrote it on their blog. And as soon as I realized what happened, I mean, he probably emailed me within an hour. I just called them and the guys who actually did the Inception parody, and I just said, you know, guys, I'm sorry. I don't know what else to say. Like, we just fucked up. We ripped off your shit. And I told him right there on the phone, I said, how do we make this right? I said, we could, you know, put a retroactive credit on the show. We could, you know, whatever. And they were so fucking sweet and understanding and nice about it. Honestly, probably too much so. They, right in the moment, they're like, nope, that makes sense. You know, they were really, they're fans of ours. And they just, I can't, they were just immediately totally awesome and sweet about it. And so we're going to go to New York in a couple months and take them out to dinner and thank them, because they're, one, they're really funny guys, and two, we did kind of rip them off, although we didn't mean to.
And it was just one little tiny, teeny, tiny part, so.
Yeah, but anyway, it wasn't to them. They you know, they put a lot of time in the thing. And they definitely, if you haven't seen their thing, go online and see it. It's fucking it's funny. I think it's called Inception Characters Don't Know Inception or something like that.
Oh, my God.
And it's really good, so. That's hopefully helps explain that stupid thing that we did a little bit. And I would say this episode's pretty funny. Actually, it turned out pretty good.
Yeah, all this stuff we came up with. We came up with the sheep herder.
Yeah, and Sheepshin. Like, we thought that was really funny.
Yeah, once we knew we had a sheep herder and the word Inception and we had Sheepshin for the title, we were
all that good stuff. Yeah, we came up with that on our own. All right, let's move on.
I'm actually herding sheep.
So this is where things just get all fucked up, because basically we decided we'd been wanting to do kind of another Coon episode. We wanted to do a Coon sequel, and we'd been wanting to do it for a while. And so we decided to do this, having no idea that the part two of the Coon would end up becoming a trilogy. So as we started,
I think we thought it was going to be a one parter when
we
started.
Yeah, it was just going to be a one part thing, and we were going to do the. Basically, the whole, just the idea that Cartman was trying, he now had Coon and friends, and we'd sort of bring Mysterion back and have the other kids and try to kind of guess a little bit at who's who. But then, this character, Captain Hindsight, comes around, and he won't be a part of Coon, and for kind of like a, you know, holdout in a union or something like that. And then, really, the show was just trying to get this real superhero, Captain Hindsight, to join Coon and friends. And that was going to be the whole show.
But then Captain Hindsight. Captain Hindsight was inspired by the BP oil spill and some people's reaction to it.
Like James Cameron.
It was especially James Cameron. There was a thing where James Cameron, who's obviously a fucking really smart guy, like it was something, and probably taken out of context, he said something like, "Well, these people down in BP trying to clean this up, or the people working on this, are obviously totally stupid, you know, and they should have done it this way." And it's totally, it's true that, like, whoever was in charge fucked up, obviously. But once there's, like, a thing on the bottom of the ocean spewing oil a mile down, it really becomes like, you know, shit does happen, and it's hard to, and once it happens, it becomes like a bunch of Captain Hindsight saying, well, I wouldn't have done that. It's like, really? You know, a bunch about deep sea, like, oil drilling? And James Cameron, because he's floated around the Titanic stuff, he does know a lot about deep sea stuff. But it just had a real, like, oh, thanks, Captain Hindsight. And then somebody said, you know, why don't we literalize that character and rip on kind of journalists, and how journalists, that's basically, they're all so smug about their hindsight all the time, but it's really easy to always report on something and say what should have been done.
Right.
And that was Captain Hindsight's greatest power.
And then sort of what happened was, it gets to be, you know, as usual, we're writing the stuff Thursday, Friday, it gets to be Saturday, and we're starting to get deeper into the story, and we're like, well, you know, what can BP, you know, the joke of, like, they did an oil spill, but what's the parody version of that? And we're like, oh, they tore open a hole in another dimension. And we've been wanting to do, for the longest time, for like years, we've been wanting to do this big H.P. Lovecraft thing, where we basically, because I'm into the board game Arkham Horror and started reading, you know, I've always kind of, since I was a kid, been into some of Lovecraft stuff. And
So we had them start designing all these sort of other creatures from another dimension based on H.P. Lovecraft stuff, including Cthulhu. And we were just always, we always had, and we even had full done scenes and everything. It was always going to be a Halloween special, but we just never could really figure anything out. So we're like, you know what? Let's just use those characters. We'll just use them. And it just seems such a waste to use all that for one little joke of they tore a hole into another dimension.
Right.
So we're like, well, let's just make it. And then it just suddenly, we're like, you know what? Let's make it two parts. We'll do another two-parter. And maybe what we'll do is in part two, we'll reveal finally who Mysterion is. And we definitely didn't know at that time that the two-parter was going to become a three-parter, but shit happens.
Yeah. Well, let's move on to part two and talk about what great things happen in it. So this episode obviously has the work of, we're showing off our very talented storyboard character design department, because they did all these comic books, and starting with a whole comic book thing like this, and I think this stuff just looks amazing. And if you're lucky enough to be able to see this in HD, because I know a lot of people can, it looks awesome. And it's really added a whole cool element to this. Look at that, it looks so cool.
And so we knew, you know, basically, okay, we're gonna answer who Mysterion is, and even some people in the writers' room were like, well, who is Mysterion? And I'm like, it's Kenny. And at some point during the end of making the original Coon episode, Matt and I had decided it was Kenny, and we knew. And so the thing was is that when we then retroactively were looking back at the Coon, when you look back at that first Coon episode now, knowing that Mysterion's Kenny, it's really kind of satisfying and cool. So we thought, well, maybe let's not just take the whole episode and then at the end finally reveal Mysterion's Kenny. Let's let people know kind of right away. And let's do it not in this big, giant, here's the reveal kind of way, but just very throwaway. And that's why we decided to do it in this way of like, whoa, hey, Kenny, calm down. Like, that's the reveal. Which you thought was kind of cool. But now we really expected, okay, well, we'll get through this. We'll have Cartman go down, get Cthulhu. He'll come back and try to fight the boys and you know, whatever. But things just sort of
then took off, and they had to do three parts.
But then what happened was, what's his name made his commercial.
Well, LeBron James made his commercial somewhere in these couple weeks. That silly, like, what should I do commercial?
Yeah.
What should you do? It's like the most cynical commercial of all. And I really, really, really appreciate and look up to people who can do things that cynical. But that thing, man, that just was like a whole new level of like, yeah, what should I do? Like, how about don't be a dick?
And we were like, wow, that is the perfect. And I don't
really
think
you don't know what you should do.
Cartman doesn't do it till the next episode, but we're like, that's a perfect Cartman response. Like, when he gets in trouble and his mom's pissed at him, it's like, Mom, what should I do?
What do you want me to go back, you know, like, to the day I did that and not do it?
Let me put this on you.
Yeah. Your fault. Yeah, why don't you have to answer for this now?
Yeah, you answer for this.
Yeah, it's like, not my fault, it's your deal.
But we went back and forth a lot with how, you know, when exactly to reveal that Kenny was Mysterion, and sort of when to, and also, you know, when to then, obviously the big thing that became the story was the fact that it's the first time we say that Kenny is aware of his dying all the time.
Yeah.
And that there is some kind of link to the mythos. And so it just sort of all started making sense when we were reading more of the Lovecraft stuff and this whole thing with Cthulhu, where there's this whole thing that's like that, you know, which sleeps forever can never die, and whatever the quote is, that's like, wow, this is about a thing that lives forever, and this is about sort of immortality. And so you know, let's play into the mystery. But we also knew, like, let's not sit here and figure out an answer. That's why so many TV shows do this, like Lost or whatever. It's like, let's not just say here's the answer, and because that's so unsatisfying in a way. And we also thought, if we really say, here's exactly what's going on in these shows, you know, this soon, that then now every time Kenny dies, he'll be like, oh, okay, there's that thing.
Right.
Rather than kind of still keeping it a bit mysterious, but explaining some. And obviously just the fact that Kenny is for the first time saying he's aware that this happens and that he dies and wakes up and tortures him.
He hates it, yeah.
We just thought that was such a cool thing, and that's when we're like, man, is this going to turn into a three-parter? Because it just seemed like a big, weighty thing. And all the comic book stuff was looking so cool that we just wanted to see more of it ourselves. Yeah.
So we did three. This guy, we decided afterwards, this dude right here, this cult leader, we should have made the goth kids.
Yeah.
That was a fuck
up. So always stuff like that happened. This scene was done pretty early on, and then a few days later, we're like, oh, let's bring the goth kids in. It's like, ah, oh, then that guy should just be the goth kid, but you run out of time. You can't go back and change everything. It's part of why it just has the feel it does, which is a feeling of this isn't quite done.
Yeah, that, it's called the half-baked. Fresh from the oven, but sort of not quite done yet. But you're so hungry, you eat it anyway. Let's move on.
Finally, we got to part three, which we knew. We always knew we were going to start with the Mint Berry Crunch comic because it just seemed like the right way to go. And we actually even knew when we thought this was all going to be a one-part thing, just because the show started with Cartman reaming Mint Berry Crunch for not really being a superhero. We kind of thought, okay, whatever happens in the end, Mint Berry Crunch has got to be the one that actually saves the day, and that'll piss Cartman off. And so basically just took that idea and kept it till the end of part three.
Yeah. I love this comic book stuff. The other thing is, in this episode, you'll notice we just got rid of Captain Hindsight. We couldn't figure out anything for him.
Yeah.
And we said, you know what, instead of fucking shoehorning him in, he just won't be here.
Yeah.
And unless you're a huge Captain Hindsight fan, you probably won't notice.
And all the, so all the Captain Hindsight fans can wait till next season when we do the three-parter of Captain Hindsight. But this was a big, you know, so again, this was sort of deciding how much to reveal. We actually do know a bit more about why Kenny has his power and what it exactly is and everything, and we're not just saying that. We really kind of do, but we just didn't want to sort of spill it all right here because we thought it's fun to, we might want to see Kenny being Mysterion again. We didn't want, and that's so unsuperhero-like to be like, here's your answer or you're done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the mystery should keep going on a little bit. And so, but I will say that there's one part in this show that's not spoken, that's sort of a hidden thing that reveals a bit more of what is actually going on, if you look for it.
With Kenny?
Yep.
Oh, really? Wow. I wonder if I know what that is. I probably do.
It's in one of the panels. It's in one of the
storyboard panels. Yeah. I mean, I think we're definitely going to, I mean, I can't wait to do another Mysterion Kun show. I think this is cool. I mean, I love the comic book stuff. It gives gives the characters these other, what's cool is it's like we've done stuff before with like Lord of the Rings or anime where the kids have kind of like personas and then we play it within that style and stuff. But I feel like this, especially because with Cartman and Kenny, and we haven't really done it with Human Kite and Tool Shed yet or, you know, Tupperware. But with a couple of them, it isn't just, they're playing, but it's a little more than that. Like it's, you know, it means, Mysterion, you can tell, means more to Kenny. This is where he can kind of be more than he is when he's his normal self. And Cartman cares about his Coon franchise, you know. And so there's just something really, it kind of gives the whole show like a whole new place to go. That we haven't had in a while. It feels very like a big idea. So I think I want to definitely do more of these when we figure out what it could be.
And probably most importantly, what people should know is that at the very end, when the little alien or whatever he is comes down and tells Mint Berry Crunch his origins, that's actually based on, what's that guy's name?
Based on Lamal, the lead singer of Kajagoogoo.
There's a, if you look at the music video of Never Ending Story, because of course there was some elements of this that felt like Never Ending Story with Cartman and Cthulhu. And so we looked at that, and anyway, that we sort of did the haircut based on that haircut.
He has Lamal's haircut.
Is that maybe that's ripping shit off too? Maybe we shouldn't be doing that.
We shouldn't be ripping off haircuts.
Maybe we should give that guy a call. But but also the,
I would say I'm kind of bummed Mint Berry Crunch is gone forever because I thought Mint Berry Crunch.
Oh, he'll be back.
Mint Berry Crunch is a great character.
He said I'll be back someday. Yeah. So
I'll be back.
Maybe next show.
Yeah.
But and then the other big thing was with Cartman and Cthulhu. All the, there's these references to Totoro, which was just like one of,
well, that was in two, and then in this one is the,
there's one, isn't it in this one too? There's another Totoro.
No, that was in the second one, wasn't it?
Oh, I thought we did one more in this one.
Cthulhu.
Yeah, that was.
That's the end of the
story. What am I thinking of though?
No, this is the Warner Brothers one of the.
Oh yeah.
Dog
the dog and the kitten.
And
yeah,
the little
kitty
who scratches his back.
Yeah, which is like one of the best Warner Brothers cartoons ever.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's that.
Let's move on to Crème Fraîche. The king.
Passengers said the carnival.
So this is the last run of our 14th season. Last show of our 14th season, and it's called Crème Fraîche.
It's actually probably my favorite one. Because,
and like I said, like it's a seventh show, so it kind of feels weird and different. And in doing that, it became like a really fun, funny show.
There's just certain shows that I just, in every retake set, every single shot that I'm watching, I'm laughing my ass off, and this was one of them. But a lot of it just came, we've been wanting to do kind of a Food Network show for a long time just because I'm such a big, that's probably the channel I watch more than any channel is Food Network. It got me into cooking and everything, and I love all those shows. And I watch all, and he's not on Food Network, but all the Gordon Ramsay stuff I watch all the time too. So it was supposed to be just, it really was supposed to be a big sort of celebrity chef show and get into all that. But then we were going to have this little tiny runner of Sharon doing shake weight, and it just took over the show. It just, because somehow the character of the shake weight was a lot more interesting than anything else that was going on. But obviously, the shake weight thing, and the shake weight thing, obviously, it happened quite a while before this, so it's a bit of it seemed kind of like, oh, well, that's old new. Everyone's already joked about that, but we just kind of thought this was a really funny. Once it started talking, we're like, okay, well, this is a whole new thing. And, of course, the refreshing mist in your face.
Mm-hmm. The cool-down mist. For me, this show is about, like, I love the ripping on the term creme fraiche.
Yeah.
I just think that's the most ridiculous fucking term.
We're trying to make it so that now when anyone goes to a restaurant and a waiter says, here's some creme fraiche, that they get laughed at.
Yeah, just please order creme fraiche. Go creme fraiche, because it's just such a overused.
But my very, the thing is, I love so much of the show, and I love shows that have a lot of shots that just go on and on, and like where it's just one big shot, because it means lots of stuff's going on, and you're not, and the stuff with Sharon and the shake weight is just so great, and you kind of, everyone can relate to what's going on. But my favorite part of this show is at the end when Randy says, oh wow, an old fashioned.
And you know exactly what he's talking about.
It's just like,
because you watch the shake weight.
We don't even know where, like somewhere in the room, we just started calling it an old fashioned. And it just, even like, it way better than creme fraiche. We're hoping that catches on and that everyone starts calling a hand job an old fashioned.
Just the fact, basically, the whole episode, in that first shot where they're on the couch, if she just would have given him an old fashioned, none of the episode would have happened.
Yeah.
Like, their marriage would be okay.
Yeah.
She wouldn't have had to hang up and gone and tried to work out equipment. Yeah. Would have ended up in the Bahamas to get her groove bag. He wouldn't have gotten all crazy about food, all this pent-up
just
sexual
one
intention.
Old-fashioned would have taken care of
just
the whole
one
thing.
Old-fashioned. And that would have been a 30-second episode. I like the fact, too. I think it was kind of interesting. First, we thought it was kind of a crap-out ending, but it turned out to be really good, the idea that we're building to this big competition, big Iron Chef-style competition, that obviously, you know, it was a big set piece would be cool, but it actually doesn't fucking matter because you don't care about that. And then you go home and he can't find his creme fraiche and he gets an old fashioned and that's it. And you never even get back to those guys.
I haven't had an old fashioned in a long time.
And I like the fact that he farts before he goes to sleep. And she smiles. It's like everything's okay. Like,
normally,
you know,
what's so funny is that normally you would do, because we came up with that at the end and we're like, okay, well, now you've got to go and set up old fashioned. Like, now you've got to have someone say what an old fashioned, or mention old fashioned in the beginning. And we're like, no, fuck it, let's not. Like, that just comes out of nowhere. Old fashioned.
An old fashioned.
Oh.
And just, and the really, I like the last scene's really good with the, where shake weight's basically like Michael Landon.
Yeah.
And he's like, well, my work's here done.
Returning to heaven.
I'm going to go back up to heaven.
But anyway, there's season 14. Thanks a lot for watching and listening to our stupid shit.
Cool. Thank you.
Get yours today.
So welcome to the season 15 commentary. Usually we do our commentary right after we're done doing the shows, which would have been a couple of months ago in November. Right now it's January 2012. And I don't know about you, Trey, but I was all the holidays. I was just looking forward to this.
Yeah,
these
I couldn't wait to come do this.
It was weird to not have done it, and I've just been aching to do it. So this was Human Centipede, which also was the subject of the 6 Days of South Park documentary that our friend Arthur Bradford did that people might have seen on Comedy Central. This was the show that we were in production on that was in that documentary.
Yeah, and this whole season was the season we did basically right after the Book of Mormon opened, so we kind of went through this crazy few months of opening Book of Mormon and being there in New York and doing all that. And then we had a couple weeks off and came and did South Park. And so on the one hand, we were kind of like freaked out we might be too frazzled. But on the other hand, our brains were kind of working well. So I actually remember this half of the run being like not terrible.
Yeah.
It was actually like, the ideas came pretty quick because I think we were just still, our brains had been worked out.
And this one came from, I think, Trey, you talked about like just signing, you know, having to log on and wanting to buy some iTunes or something, having to click OK and agree for the 800th time to the iTunes thing because they update it like 5 times a year or whatever.
Yeah, it was literally the night every time you use it. Before our writers' meeting that night before, I just had to update iTunes. You know, you always have to update iTunes, and it's so frustrating sometimes.
And then it's not that much better.
Yeah, and you're just always clicking on agree, agree, agree. And then I just kind of thought, like, I wonder what I'm agreeing. Like, nobody ever reads that whole thing. You always just scroll to the bottom so that agree highlights and you can click on it. But so then the whole thing came on. Like, what if you're agreeing to something really messed up? And it came, of course, from seeing the Human Centipede movie.
I don't know who said Human Centipede, because I don't know. Whenever somebody said that, we were all
pretty
proud of ourselves.
Well, I think we were talking about making fun of it. We were talking about doing a parody of Human Centipede, and then I think that
you know, it's like, well, what if you're agreeing to something really messed up, like being, you know, ass to mouth, and then I think human centipede came right out. And then, you know, then you know you have a show.
Basically. Once you say human centipede, you're like, well, we've just got to go do that.
And this was like, what, like 6-7 months before Steve Jobs died?
Yeah, and we sort of thought about that. That sort of sucked.
Yeah, because he was on a downward spiral.
Well, he's been sick for a long time, but we kind of made him just like what it sounds like he sort of is if you read that the book about him, which was he was a hard worker and like he drove people. He just was like a perfectionist, you know. So we kind of made him like that in this episode. He's a little bit mean, but he was apparently pretty mean in real life.
We were just worried he was gonna die the day this aired or something, or like the day before, and then we're gonna look really mean. But I remember that
there were a lot of people too. I remember a lot of people from this episode that were like, "Holy shit, that's the grossest thing I've ever seen," and they didn't know about human centipede.
Yeah, we're like, "Dude, we didn't think of that."
I had people ask me that because you know, because Human Centipede wasn't the biggest movie in the world, you know, right. but once you know that, once you know it, you don't ever. Really
no, I remember like it was like almost a year before this that Vernon, one of our writers, was like. Have you seen the trailer for this movie, Human Centipede? And he told us what it's about, like, and we're like, no, shut up. That's like, obviously
this is real.
A joke. Like, and then we finally saw the trailer, like, no way is someone actually making this movie. So it took us. And then I think it was like, yeah, several after it had come to the theaters, and then I finally got the DVD of it, and it was just like the anticipation of how bad it was going to be, like, was way worse than what it actually was. Like, when you're watching it, you're just kind of like, well, this is dumb. And you can't believe that there's. If you watch Human Centipede and then imagine that there's a crew around them and like a guy with a boom thing and someone there was a script supervisor and like these people ass to mouth and diapers, you're like, didn't anyone at some point go, you know what, guys, let's not do this. This is like kind of fucked up.
Nope. Luckily they didn't.
Yeah. All right, well, let's move on to Funny Bot. That's probably all we have to say about
Eric, we can't afford that one.
This is our episode called Funny Bot, and we had the idea for Funny Bot. It was one of these ideas that was just like in every season for like 4 or 5 years.
We've been talking about Funny Bot for at least 5 years.
Just like a big funny robot, and the original idea of it was going to be that Jimmy got invited to this big stand-up comedy festival in Japan, and that it turns out all the Japanese were just inviting people there because they were going to put it up against their Funny Bot, and Funny Bot was this like... giant robot like the size of a skyscraper that ended up destroying Tokyo. And for some reason, I mean, it was just...
We had a whole Enter the Dragon thing, too. That's how they compete. I don't know why we didn't do
that. We never could come around to the idea. And then we finally decided this season, we're like, well, what if FunnyBot isn't in Japan? It's like at South Park, and it's just like normal human size. And we decided to base it more off of an episode of Star Trek called The Changeling with Nomad.
Pretty soon we're going to get through all the episodes of Star Trek. Yeah. We're not going to be able to parody anymore.
We're slowly doing it.
We're like about 15 in.
Yeah. But it was also because we basically got invited to go to the Comedy Central Comedy Awards. And Matt and I got this invitation saying, congratulations, you've been nominated for a comedy award by Comedy Central. And we're like, well, we better. But
on the other hand, like, we don't want to be.
Yeah. Like,
it's like when... What was it? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was like us and Family Guy and like...
Yeah, but it was also like like your mom is the teacher and you're nominated for Student of the Week. You're like, Mom, you can't give me Student of the Week.
Yeah. So they're like, but they begged us. And we were in New York doing Book of Mormon. And they're like, you got to come to the Comedy Awards. And we like didn't want it because, you know, you look stupid going up there and like and accepting an award from your own network. Like, on the one hand, like if we win, then it's like we look like douchebags. And if you lose, you really look like douchebags. So it's like, but they kind of talked us into it and begged us to go and thought it was going to become this big thing. And then we were sitting there at the Comedy Awards talking about how stupid the whole idea of a comedy award was.
Right.
And then we decided to make a whole South Park episode about it, about Jimmy putting on comedy awards and nobody came. And then that's when we're like, oh, we could finally use that funny bot idea if it's finally, you know, a funny robot that ends up being the funniest. And it was also one of those times where I believe it was on Sunday of making this episode that the announcement came out that they had shot Osama bin Laden.
Mm-hmm. And I was in the office. I remember I was walking by Eric Stahl's office, and he had it on TV. That's right.
Yeah. And we already had the thing in where... didn't we already have the thing where... We already had all the Tyler Perry stuff in, for sure.
Yeah, that was already...
And so I think that we then decided... to do the joke at the end where Obama says the exact same things he said, and it turns out to be about Tyler Perry. We put that in sort of the next day on Monday.
And the winner is.
I think that might be it about FunnyBot.
Yep.
Let's go on. Let's move on to the next one. So this is our royal pudding, which I remember when we started talking about this episode, Anne, I think, and maybe Susan, they were talking about, it was when the UK royal wedding was going on. And me, I was just like, I fucking hate that stuff. That's stupid. No one cares about that. You know what I mean? Like, I was like, our audience is going to, I mean, we had this big argument, remember, about like the royal wedding and like if that's a big enough subject. And I was like, that's fucking stupid. No one cares about that. And I was pretty wrong because it was like a big, you know, everyone else was paying attention to it. But then that's where they just like, I think it was making fun of that, the cadence of the way they talk about it. It was like, what if we do it in Canada?
Yeah, because the pieces I saw of it were that thing of like of some narrator talking and going, you know, watching the whole thing and saying, well, this is the tradition. This is what we do here. And just like, this is all so weird. And so we decided to sort of combine the idea that no one cares. And of course, whenever we're talking about something no one cares about, we make it about Canada.
Yeah. But also it made it so it was not what I liked about it was like wasn't about the UK. It wasn't about them. You know what I mean? Those them specifically. Yeah. We just made it in Canada.
But these, yeah, these bit, I remember we did this whole bit right here first, just as sort of a sketch on Thursday, just to see if we thought it was going to work. And so it's kind of cool because it was sort of one of the scripts that's just like a sketch, really, that goes on a long time. And it worked so well as a sketch that then we had the idea of
bring it back in the end.
Yeah, and having
the conclusion,
having Ike really care about it. And then. And then when we added that, you know, what was the stakes because Ike was missing and we figured out the whole play and everything, so.
Yeah, because we had just done that. That was pretty much all we knew about at that time because we just done all the rehearsals for Book of Mormon.
It ended up being, and then we ended up with
Tooth Decay.
Yeah. At the end. I don't know why.
I don't know.
I think that was it. We didn't know what else to do.
It's
but it doesn't matter. That's the nice thing about being in Canada is it just doesn't matter.
And what did we get for? We got some really interesting like Native American speakers to do that.
Yeah. We actually got.
I don't think it was. I don't know if it was a.
I don't think they were Eskimo.
I don't know if they were like from Canada, but they were Native American. We got them. They were in LA. I think they were a different. One of the California tribes, and we had them, and they did that, the voice of that, which is so cool. It just had such a, like, a, that was one of the scenes, too. Remember, we had, like, a version where we did it, and it was, like, not funny. We wanted that real National Geographic feel to the, to the voices, make it funny, to make it, like, legitimately, like, that's Canadian.
We actually had, like, two other scenes of Mackie screaming at the little kids, but they ended up getting cut, because. It was too long. He actually took them to Niagara Falls for some reason.
He was going to take them to Niagara Falls because they were not being serious about like Tooth Decay.
Right.
And then that's how we were going to get them all together. Mm-hmm. But then we decided to bail on it.
They didn't need to be all together. All right, let's go to TMI. This is another episode that just started with a really simple little idea, which was I just had the idea of wanting Cartman to see that the school had published. How much each student had grown in the past 6 months or whatever it was, and that he was going to think that it was about their penis sizes and be furious. And we started, and I was just like, I just thought that was funny. And then we're like, well, maybe it could be like an anger management show, and that could be that Callis is just that Cartman's really angry. But then it ended up being even more about penis sizes than anger management.
It was that thing of, I remember when I was growing up that, like, you know, people start talking about penis size, that you have a big dick or like this or that or the other, and you have no idea. Like, you're 8 or you're 10 or you're 12 when all this shit comes up, and you just have no idea how you stack up against other guys. And, you know, our kids obviously are so young, this is where they learn to care about it, kind of, because before they really don't care. Like, in this scene, only Cartman does.
Yeah.
But then Randy, and then we did the Randy, like that there was anger management, and obviously like that is why guys get mad. But it isn't just because you have a small dick; it's because of the kind of horse race, or you know, the sort of arms race, the way it's kind of presented. The kids get that way.
Yeah, because I remember we were talking too a lot about the whole BMI index thing and how you know, because a lot of people think that that's not really the best way to figure, because it's always really bothered me, because according to the BMI, I'm obese. And I'm like, I mean, I'm not like athletic, but I wouldn't use the word obese. And I mean, according to BMI too, I should weigh like 185 pounds, which is like what I weighed in high school, and I look like a total toothpick. Like, I don't really buy it. So that's why the whole TMI thing was just like all these weird numbers to get to your actual, and that it's all kind of just depends on whether you want it to look bigger or smaller.
Right. And who's making up the formula.
Yeah.
Yeah. We did a lot of BMI. We really worked on that equation for the TMI for a while to make sure it was copacetic.
I don't even remember anything else about this episode.
I remember Randy gets in a fight with that woman as soon as she comes in and she's like, no, this isn't the official TMI. How's this episode end? I don't even remember.
We just did that song. We just did like a big, like, they decide to change.
Oh, right.
And then
right.
It's just like
everybody's happy.
Yeah, a song that everyone's happy. Because we tried to make that joke of just like everyone, obviously with a small penis, people in like Hummers and shit.
Just tell guys they have big dicks and everyone think that the whole world would be better off.
I remember we came up with a lot of different ways to go with this show, but it all felt like that show, The List.
Yeah.
Everything we did, where we could never really have the girls in school really care about it. And it was just, I remember too, early on, we had that scene where he's in the principal's office. And this is, again, before we even knew what was going, but where he's pissed off at the principal saying, you know, she's like, why did you publish the boy's penis size? He's like, why did you? And it was just this cool scene that we sort of built the whole show around.
Yeah. It has a good beginning, this show.
Yeah. First act's real strong.
Cool. Well, on that, let's move on.
2.4 inches. Really nice, Butters.
This is our Crack Baby Athletic Association show, which was actually, I remember it was going to be the first show of the season, but we just didn't have... enough. We didn't have the part figured out where Kyle was going to be kind of torn of whether to join or not. So there was nothing kind of emotional going on. Whereas, of course, Human Centipede, there was so much.
That's why we decided to go with that.
But we just sort of had the idea before the season started. We just sort of had the idea about, you know, talking about the NCAA, but making it about crack babies instead.
Yeah, we had talked about making fun of the NCAA. And the fact that they don't pay the players before. And then I remember, because I watched in like 1 week, I saw this Frontline did something on the NCAA, and then like Bryant Gumbel, Real Sports, did something. Like, it started to be that thing where it wasn't just like, it's been one of those conversations that I've always had like at a bar, you know what I mean? Or just like one of those weird like 2 a.m. dorm room conversations, as people like to say. But then all of a sudden it was like real, felt like real journalists were like starting to be like, hey, wait a second, this is fucked up.
Maybe it was just right around March Madness.
It was just before March Madness. Maybe it was just me that I saw that, but it seemed to be like, hey, you know, people are really starting to talk about this. And then the more we talked about it, we had a lot of the funny, like, crack baby jokes and the slavery jokes and stuff. But then it was really when we hit on that thing of making Kyle like the guy in the, is it The Firm?
No, Wall Street. Oh, we talked about the old
Wall Street. Yeah, Wall Street was the big one. And the Devil's Advocate, too, a little bit, of that idea of, you know, how much of your morals are you going to, you know, how far can you, how can you look the other way when you're working for some immoral kind of organization? And it was the Charlie Sheen in Wall Street that we kind of modeled.
We all had to go watch Wall Street that night, I remember.
And just how Kyle basically finds himself saying things to Stan, because we made Stan the foil that, like, Stan, as Kyle, as he says something to Stan, Stan just has to look at him, and Kyle realizes, fuck, I sound exactly like Cartman. Or he says, you sound like Cartman right now, but Kyle just eventually
I remember we took more and
out.
More, as it went on, we took more of Stan's lines out so that Stan actually never says anything back to him.
And Stan just sits there and looks at him.
It was these scenes
doesn't
of debate.
Doesn't he say you sound like Cartman right now?
I think he finally does, but it used to be that, I remember the scene was originally that Stan kept saying, wow, you sound like Cartman. And then Kyle would be like, oh, yeah, well, da-da-da. And it was just this normal kind of argument. Right. And then the more we took Stan's lines out and just had him staring at him, the more it became this kind of joke of an obvious argument that was going on. And
Kyle's arguing with himself, basically. Yeah. And Kyle is usually the one who is talking about the moral issues, so he doesn't really need – he just has to look at Stan. Stan just looks at him and he knows.
And I remember, too, we originally were trying to animate the crack babies actually playing basketball. And we were talking for, like, well, what are they going to actually do? Because they, you know, do they actually have a ball? Do they try to dribble? Yeah. You know, and we did these kind of tests and everything, and nothing was as funny as just as it would kind of be in the viewer's head.
Yeah.
So we decided to not even do that and let it all be hypothetical, and you kind of hear about it, but you never really get to see exactly. Sometimes in doing comedy, it's better to let people imagine what it would be. It's better.
You know, what was funny was it was around the time of this episode that
So Trey and I went to see you, and now CU wants to hit us up for money. We went to the University of Colorado, and like one of the reasons I really don't like college athletics, I'll be totally honest, is because I don't like college that much. So it just like doesn't even do athletics. It doesn't like college. And then we got this call that was like this was last year around the time this episode came out. The CU football coach, the Alumni Association called, I think, or something. Once he's going to be in LA doing some recruiting or something. He wants to stop by and say hi to you and Trey. Remember that?
Yeah.
And we were like, did you see the episode we did last week? Did you
watch? Well, and someone from CU called Butters, too, remember? And was like,
he wrote
upset
him an email.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sort of upset and like, oh, you don't understand. Actually, the football actually doesn't make any money, you see, because we spend that money on other sports. It's like, but then you did make fucking money. You just spent it on other sports. Like,
we're not talking about what you're spending it on.
You can spend it on whatever you want. You're making all the money and the players are playing for free. So I'm really glad we did that slavery scene. I think that ended up really funny. And just like, without trying to explain it in some way, it's just like Cartman, of course, he just thinks that, you know, the NCAA has cracked this amazing business model, which, by the way, they have.
Yeah.
You know, so. All right, let's move on.
There's 6 hospitals within a 10-mile radius, and all we do is pit the crack babies against each other with a little bottle of crack.
So this episode started as sort of a combination of 2 ideas. We kind of had for a while the idea of the difference between, like, basically, we used to have a friend named June who was our Japanese friend, and he really didn't like Chinese people very much, which was really funny to us when, like, Japanese people are racist towards Chinese people and Chinese people are racist towards Korean and stuff like that. It's like, really makes us laugh.
Yeah, seeing racism in a from a point of view where you don't know anything, you're like, what, you guys hate each other? I mean, and they, you know, there are other people that look at us and Americans and do the same thing. Like, what? You know, like, or Slovakians hate Czechs and stuff like that. It's like, what? You know?
So we had the idea that, you know, that, for kicking around for a while, that a Japanese guy was going to open a restaurant right next to the City Walk guy so that we could have a Chinese guy and a Japanese guy going at it. And then we also had this idea where Butters is diagnosed with multiple personality disorder. And it really was, I think we started going on this episode and a few of the scenes before. It's one of those shows that it seems like at the end we'd kind of planned it out all along, that because it turns out that Butters' psychiatrist has multiple personality disorder, and he's actually the Chinese guy and has been all along. But we actually didn't think of that until like Saturday.
No, we didn't think
about
that till late.
And it was one of those big things where it's like, wow, we're taking like a, you know, not a huge character on South Park, but someone people know, and we're going to do this big thing. Like, is that okay? Like, we're going to make it that he, but it was
funny. I
think
it was too good. Oh, sorry.
A lot of the Asians in our office were actually really happy.
Yeah, I was
a lot of the
say.
People that were, because like they had always kind of like, he is pretty much he's one of the worst, like, stereotypical characters we have. That's like,
yeah, what's your comment?
And you're to, just finally, like, you know, yeah, just, to finally say, like, 10 years later, actually, he's a white guy with multiple personalities.
Of course, it's a shitty accent, you know?
Yeah. And then we did act to them, like, all along. We were like, yeah, we knew that all along. Like, we've just been waiting for the right time to do that. And they're like, oh, wow, very smart. We had this cool scene in this, too. It was like one of the first things we animated where Butters knew something was wrong with him, but he was hooked up his camera to see what it was. And the other boys said, sort of like a paranormal idea, put like a security camera in his room. And the next day they're sitting there watching it, and Butters sleeping, and they see like visitors come in and check his ass, and they see crab people come in and go, and underpants gnomes. And they're all like, oh, nothing weird happened. That's just typical stuff. And it was a really funny scene, but it ended up not making the show because it kind of, once the show took that direction of being more about his therapist, it didn't really fit anymore.
Yeah. And then we had the Psycho ending, which, if you didn't know Psycho,
you'd
be so fucking confused about that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of true. I'm afraid I have some bad news. But it was sort of going back and forth.
I think we had to go change this guy, too, after we came up with the idea. Didn't we have to change something so that he would look like?
Yeah, we actually had to make it so that it made sense that he was the Chinese
guy. Right
guy,
yeah.
And that is, yeah, that all he had to do was kind of squint and he could look like the Chinese guy.
He'd squint and comb his hair over the other way.
Wow. Yeah.
All right, let's move on. When he's outside playing.
This episode generated a lot more kind of interest than we meant it to. Like, this was the last episode of the, you know, of the run, of the spring run. And we'd had the idea of Stan turning 10 and feeling like he's getting old, kind of, you know, as a reference to our getting older. And
But like I had said before, this run actually was a pretty good one. And there's been other runs where at the end of it, we felt like we really can't do this anymore. But at the end, even during talking about this episode, we were already talking about how we could come back the next season and kind of answer some of the questions. But we did this episode, and then right afterwards was the Tony Awards. So we went out to New York, and suddenly we're getting interviewed by all the press. And they're like, so everyone's saying about the last episode, you know, it seems like you guys are done. Is that it? Is South Park over? And we were like, no, you know, but looking back at it, it kind of does look like we're kind of saying we don't want to do this anymore, but it's not really what we were saying.
Yeah, I mean, it's like there's so much in the episode that's so obviously, I can see why people thought. I mean, it's kind of so obviously us and, you know, parts of it, or there seems to be a comment within it. About
and the big thing, and obviously we did do it consciously, was like, let's do leave it hanging. Let's do have... Right. Stan's parents said, like, South Park's all about kind of resetting at the end so that the next week we can do whatever we want again. And we're like, let's not do it. Let's have it end more like, a lot of the dramas do now, where it's just like shit goes bad and shit just goes bad. And then we really didn't know by the end of this. And in fact, we didn't know until the next season started, like, how we were going to get out of it, and were we going to leave them separated, and how we were going to answer everything. But I think a lot of... The more I talk to people out here, the more I realize everyone does that in this business. Like, they'll just leave it whatever sounds best, and then they'll all get together and figure out how to go from there.
Yeah, totally. We thought that people were more responsible than us, but they're not. They're kind of the same thing. I mean, one thing we talked about a lot with this episode was that, you know, South Park basically is a movie structure in some ways, but it's a very sitcom or television show in other ways, where we don't serialize things. It's just the end of this show. The whole, you know, everything goes back to normal. We start next week. And Stan's, that's the whole thing of, like, this is just the same shit over and over. And what Sharon says in the end, it's sort of like the form of the show being one where everything's going to be okay in the end and it's going to reset, is sort of like an immature view of the world. And I think that's why, like, some of these cool new shows that are serialized, why that's been so popular lately, is because it's like it's a really cool form to just say, well, the world doesn't work that way. And so Stan gets this big lesson in the end. And I think for a viewer, you know, if you watch South Park and you're used to this happening at the end, all of a sudden that form breaks and the world doesn't kind of go back to the, you know, it's not going to have a happy ending this week.
I think there were just a lot of people that really thought it was, that we were saying, like, we might come back for a season, but that's about it. And all the articles that came out was like, does this mean the end of South Park? And we were like, no, but
I can see why. But I can see why, even though we kind of didn't mean it that way. It's because we were commenting on the actual form of the show.
The show honestly started just as this joke. We just had the joke of
Tween Wave
and this music that literally was just shitting. And at first it was going to be, that's really what it was, and people thought it was good. But then we're like, oh, what if it only sounds that way to adults? And it's kind of like Emperor's New Clothes. And that's really where the thing will. And then what's funny is that whole argument that happens between Stan's parents at the end was like written on Tuesday morning. Like, it was one of the last things put in.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole show, you know, this big thing that everyone thought was this big reason for the show actually was kind of an afterthought in a little bit. And we were hoping, I think by Sunday we started cutting things together with that Stevie Nicks song Landslide at the end. And we were just praying and praying we would get that song. I remember we got it like Tuesday night. Like, we barely got that song.
Yeah.
And we had some backups and none of it worked as well. But, it, you know, it was a cool ending for us, but we were definitely like...
We just also couldn't think of a great ending, too. Yeah. I mean, that's part of it, is like, we'd set up this kind of existential crisis for Stan, and it didn't feel like you could just shit, you know, just like out of it, because we were kind of talking about that very thing. So then to do it felt like a kind of a crap out. To keep using the pun, yeah. Once we put in Landslide and saw it, we're just like, this is cool. And I don't really know what, you know what I mean? We didn't really think too much about, like, what it was saying on a bigger level. It just felt really satisfying, like a real end to, you know, real good emotional end to the show.
Yeah. but it had our favorite, this episode actually has, I think Matt and I agreed, our favorite thing of any South Park ever, which is Duck President.
I forgot about Duck President.
And I think it was one of those
things. When we came back, I was like, I don't give a shit what we say about Stan. We just have to have Duck President.
Yeah. I just remember that every time in the retake when Duck President was on shitting, quacking and shitting, we just thought it was the greatest thing ever.
But you know what we were totally wrong about was Jack and Jill came out, and it was really good.
Yeah. We were ripping on it. This is well before. This was like.
This is when the trailer came out.
6 months before Jack and Jill came out. And we're like, it looks like it's not going to be a good movie. But man, it came out and just hit it out of the park. Boy, what a great piece of cinema that
boy,
was.
Boy, were we wrong.
All right, let's go to part two.
Jack and Jill.
So we had the summer off from South Park, and then we came back basically in the room going, okay, now what the hell do we do? And how are we going to answer all of this stuff? You know, do we leave them divorced? Do we... some of the ideas were that we were going to just keep going like this. Stan lives in an apartment with his mom, and we were just going to have the show go on like that. But, you know, almost immediately we're like, really? We're not going to have Randy around? And Randy's such a great character in the show. And, you know, the more we talked about these big things of, you know, people really liked that we took this big change, you know, this big right turn with the show, and like, how can we keep doing that? And came up with all these different ideas of how to keep it like this. And
we were going to do a serialized thing.
Yeah, do a serialized thing where he slowly, through the course of the season, tried to get his parents back together. But, like, every time we talked about it, we'd kind of run into a wall and just go, God, you know, it's like we're having to focus on the drama of it all and not be able to just do what's the funniest thing, which is how we do the show. And finally we're like, you know what? This is South Park. It's a cartoon. People, you know... It's tuned in for that reason. Like it's, you know, we finally were like, you know, we're just kind of stuck. We just don't really have a choice. Things are going to have to just reset, as much as, you know, maybe people will hate that we finally didn't reset. And now we're just going to come back and reset at the end. And we're like, well, maybe we should reset, but just make that really sad. The fact that right. We have to reset.
I remember Vernon was the one who said, oh, what if we play Landslide again and do that? That was like that kind of key. I really hated the idea of just not doing, like, really just crapping out on it. I felt like people had some real emotional connection to that last show, and we want to do something kind of satisfying, but like Trey said, we didn't want to like really go. It's like,
and just make it a sad show.
No. Make it a sad show and like all emotionally complex and shit for, you know, I don't think people would want that. I don't know if we'd be good at that.
And we knew, we had these first few scenes. We really liked this where all the typical South Park stuff was happening, but Stan was just standing there. We really liked all that stuff. We had that for a while. And we had talked about the whole sort of Matrix drinking thing, which was a big, big step to take, have Stan become an alcoholic.
Just because an alcoholic. But then at least he goes and gets to see Jack and Jill, and he really likes it.
Yeah, because he's drunk.
Because basically he's drunk. So he can handle the shittiness of the world if he gets drunk, but then that's not going to work either. I remember the big moment, I remember where I felt like, okay, I think we earned our way back. Was when we came up with the idea of Stan growing up in a real way, because I think it's a real, you know, growing up process to finally say, you know what, my parents are divorced and it's not going back. The world's not going to go back to the way it was. That's the way kids think. It's like, I just want to wake up in the same bed every day and have the same great day and do this thing. And then you get to be a certain age and it's like bad shit starts happening and you don't get to go back. You know, that's a real... really deep thought, and Stan finally gets it, and he gets it in this way that's like, you know what, it's life isn't like a fucking stupid sitcom where you have to learn some lesson, then everything snaps back, and then at that moment everything snaps back.
Right.
And I feel like that was, I was like, okay, that's cool, that feels like we earned our way back, you know, within what we had kind of set up last season. But it was hard to come. I remember it was hard to make all of this sort of line up.
Well, because we had a lot, we also had all the Asperger stuff going on, which we had talked about for a while too, doing a show about Asperger's, but in the years before, like, that word wasn't used as much, so we were just worried, like, well, if we do a show about Asperger's, everyone's going to think we're making that name up. But finally Asperger's had made it enough into the popular culture that we could do a show about how unfortunate of a name that disease is.
We always love that thing, too. If we left the show, people are like, wow, they're really sick of doing, you know, South Park now. Book of Mormon is kind of a big hit, and maybe they're sick of doing South Park. And then we won the Tonys in the off period, right?
Yeah.
And then we just thought it was super funny to then just basically almost answer the question in the title of the show of like, nope, Asperger's.
Yep.
They're just doing that fucking shit. It's still like...
Kramer's got hamburgers in his pants.
That's it. That's what we're doing. So, but I remember being done with the show and feeling like, okay, good. We got out of that
one. We got out of it. Now we can go back to just making South Park.
Yeah.
Let's move on. This is probably my favorite show of this whole season.
I think me too. I like this episode a lot.
This just came out of the idea. Really, the first idea was like, let's just have the kids playing a game of Mexicans versus Texans or versus Border Patrol.
And then we started watching some of those Border Patrol shows that are on now.
God damn it. And then it's like, yeah, watching any show that like makes cops and stuff look cool, like I get really bummed out on. Not because I don't like cops, but because it's just the cops working together with TV producers, working together with advertisers doesn't seem like a good trinity.
Yeah.
It's just always, and we've done a couple of shows that kind of make fun of that trinity, but there's Border Wars, right?
Yeah.
There's another one. There's DEA, which is kind of similar. And then we also were talking about immigration, and I read this thing about how immigration is actually a decade low right now, immigration from Mexico, that because of a ton of really, you know, serious reasons. There's like a lot less immigration right now. And then at the same time, you have these shows. It's like immigration's a big problem, and it's completely at odds with the reality. So I mean, that's how we started talking about the Mexicans going back. That became kind of that scene where the Border Patrol agent are watching the wrong way.
Yeah.
And then they get confused about what the hell they're supposed to do.
And then when we thought that Butters was going to keep playing the game and just be a little Mexican, and we saw that, we're like, oh, what's butter in Spanish? And it's, when we saw it was Montequilla, we're like, oh, that's perfect.
Yeah, because Butters has like, Butters is like a little like, hey, buddy, like a little cute name. But Montequilla sounds like kind of noble. You know, it sounds like Montezuma or something. It sounds like a big noble guy.
Yeah, this was, we had this whole first, this is another one where we just sort of, it's nice when we have the whole first scene done. Like, this was the first thing we wrote on Thursday, was this whole thing where they're playing the game, and we didn't quite know where it was going to go yet, but it's always good when you have a lot of times we just have middle scenes, and we have no idea how we're going to get in it or get out of it. This was nice to at least know where we were starting from.
Yeah, the hard part about this episode, I remember we were working on animating that last, the chase scene between, we knew, like, the idea that it somehow is going to boil down to Cartman trying to keep Butters from crossing the real border. Seemed like where we wanted to end the show.
Yeah.
But actually making that a satisfying chase was kind of a big pain in the ass to do. I remember that was like the last thing we did.
Yeah, because this was a show, I remember that this was one of those shows that was like, everyone was laughing a lot the whole week as every scene came in, so... But sometimes those are the more stressful ones, because then it's like, all I think is, okay, all I can do now is ruin it. So sometimes the ones that are getting the biggest laughs are the most stressful. Like, I remember this part with Butters. It was like, originally, I don't know why, we had never even thought of the fact that he gets lost. He was just, couldn't get over the border for some reason. So he was actually right outside the fence, outside of Cartman's. And then, of course, you know, that sounded fine. But then as soon as we watched it, and we were like, well, why can't he get over that little fence? It made no sense. And our brains were just so locked into one way that it wasn't until Sunday we're like, oh, he's just lost. He just doesn't know where he is. And I don't know why we didn't think of it sooner.
Maybe it's looking at this awesome snow. Yeah. Finally convinced us, wow, you could have got awesome
Our snow has gotten a lot better.
Look at that snow. Because
the snow's all really computer generated.
That looks like real snow right there.
And this Work Mexican Work song is a little song I wrote like 6 years ago. I think I was in Hawaii. And I was playing some little like xylophone thing that only, and for some reason this little tune came to my head. I never thought it would end up in South Park, but it did.
In Work Mexican Work.
Yeah. All right,
let's move on.
I have to get across the border. Mis amigos.